Good morning, everyone, and welcome to the 12th meeting of the Rural Affairs and Islands Committee in 2023. We welcome to our meeting our new member, Christine Graham, who is replacing Jenny Minto. And members should also note that Mercedes Villalba has left the committee, and I'd like to thank Mercedes for her contribution to the committee over the last 2 years and wish her all the best. Rhoda Grant has been appointed to the committee, but due to a previous constituency engagement, Rhoda's not going to be able to be here with us this morning and has given her apologies. Before we begin, can I remind those members using electronic devices to please turn them to silent. Agenda item one, and I invite Christine Graham to declare any relevant interests.
Thank you, convener. As Belton Braces, I'm convener of the Cross-Party Group on Animal Welfare.
Thank you. Our next item of business continues our pre-legislative scrutiny of Scotland's future agriculture policy, focusing on food production and supply chain resilience. And a welcome to the meeting, Kate Rowell, the Chair of QMS Quality Meat Scotland, Joe Hind, the Policy Manager for Scotland Food and Drink, and Paul Flanagan, Stakeholder Engagement Director from the Agriculture and Horticulture Development Board. We have approximately 90 minutes for questions and discussions. I'm going to kick off the questioning. Now, there's sectors or points in the supply chain which we know have experienced and experienced risk in the past and expected to do so in the future. So can I ask what the reasons for risks in the supply chain in Scotland, and in terms of resilience, particularly looking at farm profitability and also something that's I believe is key to sustainability in Scotland, that's processing capacity. So perhaps we'd kick off with Kate with experience on issues around profitability initially. Thank you.
Thanks very much, and thanks very much for inviting QMS to give evidence today. There are a lot of risks, and obviously the risks, the immediate past risks are very obvious. The war in Ukraine has caused huge increases in input prices. That's one of the biggest risks that farmers have faced in the past year or so. But COVID has also upset supply chains right the way through. We obviously represent people from the primary producer right through to processors. COVID was a huge shock to them as well, just recovering from that, and then you get this war in Ukraine, and then obviously the longer term risks of climate change, of labour and skills, and all those issues. I think the red meat supply chain has shown through COVID how resilient it can be. You know, there was a huge shock at the start. A lot of people adapted very, very quickly. A lot of the businesses downstream pivoted to do business differently. And they did show huge resilience overall. But there are huge challenges going forward, as we know. And we need to invest in that supply chain to make sure it continues. The big problem that we are facing is the loss of critical mass in the red meat sector. And to explain that, if we lose animals, if we lose primary producers, if we lose farmers, we don't have enough animals to then make the rest of the supply chain viable. So if you cut back on your cow numbers, the first thing that's going to happen is we're going to lose a major processor. You've got fewer processors in the game, then prices are going to go down because there's not so many people competing for the product. If you've got farmers going out of business, you don't have the hauliers there because they can't get work, so they disappear. The vets haven't got the work, so you're losing large animal vets. You've got feed companies closing down. You know, all these things are downstream from that high level, top level numbers of animals on the ground and numbers of farmers and businesses that are out there.
You'll no doubt have picked up on the letter that Chris Stark wrote to the committee regarding future agriculture policy and climate change. The CCC persist in suggesting that the only way for agriculture to reach its targets is to cut our red meat industry and actively support farmers to leave the industry. Why is that message about a critical mass falling on deaf ears?
I think the CCC in particular have got a... They have a job to do. Their job is to do with emissions, and I suppose when they write letters like that, that is them responding to that job. Your job and ours is to look much, much wider than that and look at the unintended consequences from those proposals. And the things that I've just said have definitely, you know, they're definitely a risk if we go down that route. The other thing I would say on that proposal is that it doesn't take into account livelihoods, it doesn't take into account the rural economy. It's numbers on a spreadsheet, whereas in your world and in my world, we're dealing with people's real lives and their livelihoods and their businesses. And there are so many things going on in the agricultural industry to look at mitigating emissions. And indeed, the science is not absolutely solid either yet. There was a report out just the other day in Nature Geoscience which said that the effects of global warming from methane had been overestimated by 30%. Now, that's one paper, but if there are still question marks over the actual science, I think it would be incredibly damaging to even think about going down that route, which we then can't come back from. And then discover in a few years' time that we've done the wrong thing. So I think we just need to keep making that point. As I say, I'm not here to get in an argument with the Climate Change Committee. That's their job. They've done their job. What I'm here to do is try and explain the unintended consequences that would result from any intention to follow that route.
Hey, Paul?
Yeah, I would agree with I think everything Kate's said there. I think sustainability isn't just about carbon footprints. Clearly, the Climate Change Committee have got their job to do. But what we're here to look at is, you know, we want resilient farming and land management systems. We want to look after the health of the people, the animals, and the environment. And that's a much broader view than the Committee on Climate Change have taken. And actually, in some cases, some people should be consuming more meat and dairy because they'd be beneficial to their diet. So. Clearly, each individual group has got their view to take in on that, but we need to look a bit more broader. Climate resilience, of course. We need to look at economic resilience. We need to look at the fabric of societies. So we need to take a much broader view. But I guess what I would say from an agriculture perspective, almost being a little bit self-critical, there's more we need to do in terms of demonstrating the progress that we can make towards net zero. And again, we have to get away from this discussion about gross emissions. It's about net zero emissions is what we have to be speaking about.
Joe, from a Scottish food and drink perspective, do you think that the agriculture sector does enough to show and evidence the efforts and the change they've made in terms of emissions and what's available in the future, and how can the food and drink industry as a whole add to that?
Well, I think from Scotland Food and Drink's perspective, we're grateful to be here to have the opportunity to speak, because we are quite fortunate in the position that we can look across the industry as a whole, from farm to fork. And what's been clear looking at the debate around this really important issue, this will dictate the future of agriculture, the future of land use, the future of food, massively critical elements of society for the foreseeable future. And within that, I don't think anybody's arguing or advocating for the status quo. We're all recognising that there are ways we can improve, there are things we can do around the processes. But what we need to do is recognise, as Kate touched on, that livelihoods are at stake, economies are at stake, the rural viability of communities, coastal communities, island communities, is at stake here. When it comes to topics such as meat, it's very contentious, it's very polarised sometimes. Some people would advocate for no meat. Others would advocate for more meat. We would say there is a balance here, and there is a global context to consider when you think about the impact of meat and dairy. And in terms of that global context, you've got to think about unintended consequences. If you reduce production in Scotland, yet consumption remains the same, that's displacing production potentially to somewhere where emissions are greater and welfare is lower, where we have land which is potentially not useful for other forms of farming. There is a really strong argument, and this is advocated for by all spectrums of the thinking around this, including NGOs who have put out, you know, calls for agroecology, for example. Ruminant farming is an absolutely critical element of a sustainable food system. And there is discussion around balance. And from our perspective, it's that continuing to have that discussion and bringing lots of people in is a really critical element of that.
Yeah, just before we move on, I want to keep on the response from the CCC because it's incredibly important. So it would appear that the CCC don't agree that livestock production should be something that we should continue in Scotland. They want to see a dramatic cut. But given most of Scotland's only good for growing grass, can we realistically have a resilient food and food security without having red meat production, livestock production at the heart of it? Kate?
Well, the figures that we have, so cattle and sheep production in Scotland is split into LFA and non-LFA at the minute, so less favoured areas are the disadvantaged areas, and that makes up a huge amount of the country. So not just over on the west coast, a lot of the south of Scotland is also LFA. The cattle and sheep from the LFA parts of Scotland make up £706 million. They give £706 million of output, and that is 26.5% of the whole output of Scottish agriculture. So you're talking about that section being a quarter of everything we do in Scotland agriculture-wise. So it would appear from looking at the CCC letter that they are just saying, forget about all that, focus on the bits that produce lots of things and grow trees elsewhere. But that is a huge headline figure. But when you think about the number of actual people on the ground that is applying to, you know, you've got people up glens, you've got people out on islands, and then you've got the whole associated infrastructure with that actual farm or croft. You've got all the people that feed into that, the feed merchants, the vets, the fencers, every single person that then relies on those businesses to be there to exist. And if you think about the farm croft businesses going, all those associated people then going, what have you got left? You're talking about complete depopulation of some of those areas. And we would argue incredibly strongly that is absolutely not the way we want to go in Scotland.
OK, thanks. Jim Fairley.
I thought you wanted to be just first. OK, the CCC are statutory advisers to the Scottish and the UK government, and the Scottish Parliament signed off on a Climate Change Act in 2019. So they're clearly part of this equation. But I take the point that you made earlier on about the science. Because when we had the evidence session with them here before, they said that grazed grass will probably sequester less carbon the older it gets, but there's no actual science. When we're talking about resilience, we have to talk about whether or not we have a long-term future for the livestock sector in Scotland, given the numbers that you've just given us. So, do you know of any work that is being done to look at the science that will probably tell us that old grass sequesters less carbon? Is there any work being done around about that?
I'm sure SRUC are working on that, but there's also quite a lot of work from others, including the Rothamsted Institute, who have done a lot of work on soils. They've got records going back for 150 years on soil and the potential for soil to sequester carbon. This is all evolving science, as far as I can see at the moment, and we need to, as I say, make sure that we don't go too quickly down one route based on one piece of science, which then turns out not to be correct or not to be, you know, complete. There was one thing I picked up on in that CCC letter. It referred to low carbon breeds. Now, as far as I'm aware, that is not a thing. There are low carbon genetics, but not low carbon breeds. So, you know, that one little sentence said to me, they don't really understand all this. And that is another huge potential, as far as I can see, is the genetics of cows in particular. Mm. because individual cows can vary in the amount of methane they produce by up to 50%. So if you can tie in that genetics and breed low methane cows, you're going to seriously make inroads into the targets.
Sorry, Paul.
Yeah. Can I just come back at that? So there's some evidence, and I'll get this evidence, and we'll pass it to the committee. It's a company called Devonish, who are based in the Northern Ireland. They've got a farm in the south, but they've done. It's a guy, John Gilliland, that works for HDB, just as a consultant right now. But he's done a number of things, you know, working together with, you know, livestock and multi-species swards, legumes, and in particular, what they did in Northern, what they've done is the, I think it's called LIDAR, the process by which, you know, they worked with. It's the kind of archaeology it comes from. So you can actually look at the carbon in the hedgerows, in the trees, and actually get to that that net carbon level. And I think the challenge I think we have from a sequestration perspective, especially right now, is too often we're looking at, you know, tier one, you know, international level averages, and then greenhouse gas emissions using tier two national levels, but we haven't really got the tier three individual farms. We really need to have that baseline from a sequestration perspective. But certainly from that point of view, from a sequestration point of view, and the interaction of livestock and forestry, Devonish have done some really good stuff, and I can find that and pass it on to committee. That would be really interesting.
Thank you very much. I'm pretty sure that's the same company that Professor Alice Stanton did the work on the red meat supply chain. So I think that's something that the committee are going to be looking at. In terms of profitability, one of the things I want to touch upon, particularly with yourself, Kate, is to be resilient, farmers can make money in two ways. They can either sell to the market at the cost of production plus in order to get a profit, or they can sell to the market and be supported by the government in order to allow the price of the product not to be beyond the consumer's ability to buy it. So that's my understanding of how the two ways that a farm is going to be sustainable. What role do supermarkets play in that equation?
So I suppose that one of the problems we've got in the UK in general is we have a very small number of very big supermarkets, which means that what they do can have disproportionate effects on everybody. And I'm not going to sit here and say that supermarkets are bad, because supermarkets buy a lot of the produce that Scottish farmers produce, so they absolutely are not. But it means that if they are in a price war with each other and they are focusing on their own profits and their own issues, then the unintended consequence can often be that farmers right down the line, the primary producer level, are affected quite a lot by what's happening.
I'm certainly not asking you to kick the supermarkets. What I want to get to is a factual position of how the farming community sell their product in order to be profitable. It's either through government support or it's through the market, or it's a combination of both. If our export market is limited or constrained in any way, the supermarkets then go to war with each other, and it is always the primary producer that pays the price for that in terms of how much they're going to take out of the marketplace. Is the responsibility on supermarkets, when we're talking about food resilience, to have more of a role to play in making sure that that resilience is there for the people of the country?
They do have a role to play, but I suppose ultimately it's up to government to make the policy that they then have to abide by. Supermarkets are businesses. They're going to try to make money for themselves, as all businesses do. Absolutely, it's down to the consumer, I would say, as well as government, to put pressure on supermarkets and say, this is what we want. So I suppose what we try and do at QMS is speak directly to consumers, because they're the ones that are then going to put the pressure on the supermarkets. If we can get across to them how important it is to buy Scotch beef, Scotch lamb, specially selected pork, which are all raised in Scotland, if we can get that across to consumers and they then go and put pressure on the supermarkets to say, we want to see this on the shelves, then that's going to achieve it, as well as through any government policy. The issue you've got with the whole supply chain, sorry, is that you've got processors and other secondary processors and all the other people in the middle who all need to make a living out of this. Mm-hmm. You know, that's the problem.
Given the fact that we are in a traditionally stack at high sell and low economy, people are used to cheap food mm-hmm. in this country. The supermarkets would tell us that they will respond to consumer demand. Our costs of production in this country are always higher because of the standards that we set, the standards that we as government and as consumers expect from our producers, and yet that is never reflected in the price that's paid on the shelf. So how do we ask consumers to put enough pressure on supermarkets to demand that product at a time when people are struggling to pay their everyday bills?
I know, and people talk about food poverty, and my own opinion is there's no such thing as poverty. You know, we have to separate these things. We need to have a proper return for the food that we produce right the way through the supply chain, and people need to be able to afford it. And we can't have cheap food just so that people can afford it. We need to, in my opinion, fix the poverty bit of it, not just the food poverty bit of it. The other thing I would say is, as a society, we do have a different view on food than a lot of other countries. You know, a lot of other countries, individuals will spend a bigger percentage of their income on food. They seem to have more value. They value food more. They value local food more, and that's a societal feeling. You know, if you go to the likes of France, you know, that they're very much more into local food than we seem to be here. And I would say that that's where we need to get to, and that's a societal conversation that we have to have. And we need to make sure that people understand how important it is to have local food, to have local farmers, to have local supply chains, and not always bring it down to this lowest common denominator of price.
OK. Paul, sorry.
Yes, so just a bit of context for this. At the HDB, we look after the beef and lamb and the pork for England only, so I'll kind of give way to Kate for my red meat in Scotland. But we also look after the dairy sector from a GB-wide point of view. I suppose we're trying... is how do we square the circle on this? How do we get more money back to the primary producers? And... I think, as you know, as Kate and Kate's organisation, AHDB, are doing, the route by which we do that is not by just having one group of people we sell to, which is the supermarkets. It's pushing more and more into the export markets, because the advantage of that is that, not always, but most of the time, you're going to get a higher price for that. You can talk about the provenance in terms of what's happened with Scotland, and really sell that and get a higher price. But at the same time, you're tightening the home market. So you're giving yourself more options. Now,
when you say tightening the home market, are you talking about reducing production?
No. I mean by that, if you're selling more in export markets, you're therefore the supply you're you've got going into the home market is going to be is going to be less. So if you can do that at the same time, now clearly you can't just switch and wake up on a Monday morning and say, right, I'm going to switch everything across, because that would be crazy. But getting a better balance for that and driving better returns, I think, is the best way we're going to get more returns back to the primary producers. You know, as well as, I mean, some of the stuff I guess we'll talk about during this session, some of the areas in terms of reducing climate impact will be, you know, be beneficial financially as well. Some of the areas will be there as well. But the main way we'll get money into the top line for producers and get more money into the supply chain is export.
So I'm really hogging the session. I do apologise. With convener's permission, I'll go for one final thing. If we're going to get consumers in this country to demand that they're going to eat Scotch beef, Scotch lamb, especially selected pork, surely what we have to be looking for is a point of differentiation. And it can't just be the badge. It's got to be something else. So that's eating quality, taste, all those kinds of things. Now, I have a problem personally with the grading system that we currently use, where other parts of the world are looking at how they are grading their beef in particular to focus on eating quality. My own personal view is native breeds, Angus, Galloway, Highlanders, there's a much better eating quality there. But we're not looking at the shape of the animal before it goes to slaughter. What is QMS's view on how we're currently grading the system?
So I hear this all the time and have done for the entire 5 years that I've been in the chair. We are currently in the initial stages of a meat-eating quality project. I don't have the ins and outs of that as chair, but I can definitely get you the details on where we're going with that. There has been a lot of work done on this in the past, and it's something that we've definitely picked up on. And our, in fact, our entire industry development work for next year is based on this meat-eating quality work, so I can come back to you on that. The one thing I would say that would be really quite an important signal, the public procurement sector in Scotland is worth £150 million, and it very much would lead the way as a good example if schools, hospitals, prisons, the Scottish Parliament, everybody led the way on having as much local produce in their meals as possible. And we do have some figures that have shown that this has gone backwards since COVID, actually. So we really need to be pushing on this. And you know, there's a lot of good work being done out there. The Soil Association have their Food for Life project with schools. We've been hearing anecdotally that local authorities have actually been pulling out of that because of the cost. So we need to, you know, it's maybe not a huge amount of money in the grand scheme of things, but as a sort of good example and to show leadership, I think it would be really important that public procurement goes down that route.
I'll stop there, Convener.
Thank you. We will have the opportunity to question the Cabinet Secretary on progress of the Good Food Nation Bill at a session that's come up very soon. One thing we're planning and hoping to have the supermarkets in front of us. This is a question for Joe, and you can come in with your other comments as well. We have the grocer adjudicator, but we know that that adjudicator doesn't have the ability to control price, but can you know, bring sanctions against supermarkets that delist at short notice because of rises and falls in supply and demand and so on. Do you think as part of the agricultural bill there should be legislation there that gives the grocer adjudicator more powers to bring a little bit more resilience and certainty over the supply chain?
Certainly a question to ask. I mean, we've got a close relationship with the Grocery Code Adjudicator and invited them up to Scotland to meet some of our producers and suppliers, and they took away a number of issues, I would say. That said, you know, we have to look at this system-wide. We have to look at the situation that we are in. We have a highly efficient food production and selling system. We are, you know, we produce premium produce in Scotland, and we should be proud of that and all the people that go into that and produce that great food and drink that we all enjoy at home and abroad. That should be celebrated and championed. There is therefore a tension potentially, and as Kate alluded to, the fact that we don't spend as much on food as households and communities as other countries do. So how we resolve that tension is important, and perhaps it is in diversifying markets, you know, reaching out to become a trading nation as part of a national strategy for economic transformation, making sure that we've got other routes to market. But we absolutely can't ignore the role of supermarkets in, you know, what they choose to buy for their customers. But they are, of course, minded of the fact that we're in a cost of living crisis, and they will seek good value for their customers. But the question of consumer demand is, you know, is it about accessibility and affordability and availability of the products that therefore those of us who have the wherewithal to go into a store and choose Scottish produce for our meals, which we all should do where we can, is that available to everybody? And if not, what's the solution there? How do we resolve that?
Okay, thank you. Okay, move on. Beatrice Wishart.
Thanks, Convener. I'm sorry for mucking up the questioning order. My question's around the processing capacity, and it's probably directed to Kate initially, but I noted in our papers that 50% of abattoirs in Scotland had closed between 1970 and 2000. So what does that mean for the business resilience of livestock producers, especially in rural and island areas? And how can we better support these short supply chains, bearing in mind the value of local food production and the end result, the consumers using local food?
Yeah, so as you say, abattoirs have disappeared very quickly, and that is not necessarily all financial. It's down to regulation. It's down to other things as well. It's also down to labour and skills. There are not enough people out there that want to work in processing facilities, and it is a major issue, particularly in the more remote areas. And I think we probably need to look, so that there are, I do have numbers somewhere, I think we've got about 39 processors in Scotland, but there are only a handful of really very big ones. And there are quite a lot round about the country. So you've got Shetland, you've got Mull, you've got out on the Western Isles. Where I'm from, down in the southeast, in Peeblesshire, we don't have an abattoir at all in the southeast. So it really does affect that local supply chain. So the big processors work with the supermarkets and the bigger wholesalers, but any farmer who wants to sell direct is really coming up against big issues in actually finding somewhere that can kill their animals. And then the butchery part of it as well, although we are starting to see a few more butchers who are happy to do that and are starting to see a gap in the market there. I think particularly with small abattoirs, what we need to do is change our mindset and how we think about them. The big ones are businesses, and they obviously need support and they need help, and we need to make sure that they continue because they have got such a huge value to the economy. The smaller ones are far more infrastructure, really. That's how we need to look at them. And I think the comparison I would make is that fishermen have piers and harbours that they land their catch on, and that is infrastructure. And as far as I know, I'm not a fisherman, but as far as I know, these were put in by local authorities, by government, to make sure that that could work. And they don't necessarily have to make a profit. And I think when you look at island communities, when you look at more remote areas, we need to think of small abattoirs as being the same. So not necessarily a business that has to make a profit all the time, but one that has to be there to service the local area, to make sure that that the primary producers have somewhere to go with that. So I would say a definite mindset change there would be really useful. And I know there has been a lot of talk in the past about mobile abattoirs, and there was a Scottish Government report done on it, but nobody appears to have come forward to grasp that. And I think mainly it's because of the regulation rather than the financial. It's both, but the regulation would be so difficult with a mobile abattoir. I've got one or two figures here just to say that the processing sector in general ranks really highly in the Scottish Government's input-output tables. In the Type 2 economic multipliers, it's ranked second out of 98 sectors. So it's, you know, the processing sector is really, really important, and there is capacity there to increase that, but people are often the factor that stops abattoirs from doing more because they can't get enough labour and enough skills in.
Thank you.
Rachel Hamilton.
Apologies, convener, for being late due to the train. Just on the point about abattoirs, it was something that I was really interested in, so I was glad that I caught that part, Kate. I'm just concerned that some of the... I know from experience in the constituency, in the Borders, and I'm not sure it's because of the geography, but a lot of farmers are having to go south, a fair way south, take their cattle. You know, they've got increased input costs mm-hmm. to do that because of the contraction within the smaller abattoir sector in Scotland. I mean, what is your view on that, taking into account what you've just said as well? Would you rather that Scottish cattle that were born, bred, reared in Scotland were killed in Scotland, or are you quite agnostic about it?
No. So as Quality Meat Scotland, our brands are Scotch beef, Scotch lamb and specially selected pork. And part of the guidelines for those is that they have to be processed, they have to be killed in Scotland. So we absolutely do not want people going down south with animals, although obviously if that's a business decision of theirs, that's not something that we can do anything about. But it is so important to have a strong abattoir sector in this country, and not just primary abattoirs, not just the ones who are actually doing the first part of the process, but secondary processors as well. So we only have one packing facility in Scotland. So for a lot of the other processors, they kill the animal up here, but then it goes down south to a bigger facility to be processed further, you know, cut up and packed and everything like that. So we lose quite, as an economy, we lose quite a lot of the value of that produce by sending it down south to get. And obviously those are, you know, those are commercial business decisions. That's what these companies have done. They've consolidated things to make their businesses more efficient. But that has contributed to how much of the added value is going out of Scotland.
Yeah.
So, yeah, it's very worrying.
Joe.
Yes, thanks for that. I was just going to add that, you know, in terms of thinking about it system-wide, the processing that we have in place across Scotland is absolutely critical if we're talking about resilience, because resilience isn't just... Are you OK? Chair issues.
You broke a chair.
So, you know,
carry on.
Resilience isn't just about finances, you know, and who's got the deepest pockets. It's about structure. You know, it doesn't matter how much money you have if the labour isn't there for you to recruit. And similarly with structure around processing, if it's not there, then you have to spend more to process your goods, and the value, as Kate rightly touched on, the value is lost, and that's processing across all sectors, I would say. And your FPMC is one tool that we have to do that, and we're conducting a review of that, which is great, and will hopefully lead to more availability of, you know, funding in the right way to support the industry to grow responsibly through processing and production.
I've got a question for Ariane Burgess, but how significant is the risk to the Scottish beef industry right now from the number of livestock moving south because of the additional demand, supply and demand issues south of the border? How significant is the risk to Scotch beef in Scotland for that critical mass to be lost?
Well, it's not something that we're very happy about, obviously, but it is, because it's because of a huge range of factors, including the fact that the English agricultural policy has gone down the route of removing direct payments, which means that a lot of the suckler producers down south have decided that it's not worth their while. So therefore, the finishers who need to make sure they've got numbers are coming up to Scotland to buy store cattle to take down south to finish. Now, in some ways, that's a real compliment. They're coming up because our cattle are so good. But the trouble is that just then creates more demand round the ring. It possibly has helped drive the beef price up a bit, that demand. But the fact that they're then taking them out of Scotland means that they're lost to our brands, yeah. And it is really important that you know, the work that we've put into developing the Scotch brands, and they are so widely, particularly Scotch beef, is so widely known in Scotland, that we really need to make sure that we have enough cattle going into abattoirs in Scotland to keep that critical mass up.
Thank you. Just briefly, Rachel.
If the direct payment was maintained in Scotland in the future, do you think there could be, on the back of a market demand, an increase in the suckler herds here?
It's entirely possible if the suckler beef sector in Scotland is properly supported and the investment is put in there, then absolutely. We've got you think about climate change and how the climate is changing. Our climate is fantastic for growing grass, which is what we need. People are looking for pasture-fed, grass-fed beef. We are absolutely in an ideal place. It's a huge opportunity for us in this country. We've got the rain, we've got the land, we've got the grass, we've got the skills in the farming community. We could absolutely grasp this. I do see it as a huge opportunity. But we do need support, and not just financial. We need regulatory support and everything to make that happen.
Thank you. Ariane Burgess.
Thanks, Convener. Kate, I just wanted to pick up on, I was interested about your comments about the abattoirs, and I just wanted to pick up on the bit that you were saying about the mobile abattoirs. That's something that's been interesting to me, being Highlands and Islands MSP, and you mentioned that the regulations are too difficult. Could you just unpack that just a little bit?
Yeah, so regulations around abattoirs are incredibly stringent, and it's for good reason, because it's for food safety. I mean, nobody's arguing that we just need to make it a free-for-all again. But one of the biggest issues is waste and how we get rid of the waste from abattoirs. So the regulations around that are such that if you had a mobile abattoir every place, so the ideal, I suppose, the ideal idea is that this lorry would just drive around each farm and kill the animals on the farm that they grew up on. And that's fantastic from an animal welfare point of view. But every single farm would then have to have the infrastructure in place to deal with that waste. They'd need to have all the regulations in place. And I'll just go back, because I found it really interesting. There's only one abattoir, as far as I know, that's opened in Scotland since devolution. And that's down in the Borders. It's a very small micro-abattoir. And speaking to the owners of that, they just gave me a tiny flavour as to how difficult that had been. They said they were dealing with dozens of different public agencies. And, for example, one part of their water system, there had to be a valve. And I think Scottish Water had said it had to be a specific kind of valve or they wouldn't sign it off. Environmental Health had said it had to be a different specific valve or they wouldn't sign it off, and it took months to get that valve. Do you know what I mean? It just, things like that are, it just makes it really, really difficult for these things to happen. And with a mobile abattoir, you would need that every single place it went to. The layerage would have to be up to the spec that you demand at a static abattoir. You'd have to have vets there. That's another issue that we haven't touched on. There's a lack of vets. There's difficulty getting vets to be there. You know, there's Food Standards Scotland do a really good job, but there just is a lack of vets for this. So there's a whole host of different things. It's not impossible, but it's very difficult. And I personally haven't spoken to lots of people about small abattoirs. Would say if we want to invest in them, we would be better to look at a model like Shetland, where they have a static abattoir. I think it's community owned. It can be operated by one person. It has an extra room after the abattoir that butchers can rent out, and it has all the equipment in that room that butchers can use to make sausages and things like that. So a model like that, in my opinion, would probably work better, even though you are still going to have to take the animals to it. I think it's probably more realistic than a mobile one.
So then we would have a number of those around Scotland?
Yes, in the more remote areas. And there are some of these around. You know, Mull Abattoir does a fantastic job. And actually, I discovered recently, 70% of what goes into Mull comes from the mainland. It's not just for Mull. They are operating it as a you know, really successful going concern, a really good business. And it's just making sure that we have those in the strategic points in the country that we need them.
So also, I'm hearing from your example about Shetland, that it's something about getting the right scale. So I'm aware that Orkney, I think they created one and it was maybe a bit too ambitious.
Yes.
And then there was a problem with that one.
And again, going back to the labour and skills, if you can have something that one person or two people can operate and it can be seasonal or whatever, and they can do other jobs, particularly in island communities, then that's probably ideal. Mull was closed for a few months, I know, because they lost their slaughterman, and they had, you know, it took them a while to get another one, and that just shows how key one person is in the whole thing in those smaller situations.
Thanks very much. It was helpful to get that detail.
Thank you.
Alistair Allen.
Thank you. Just to pick up on the point about infrastructure and or capacity, rather, specifically around haulage, I don't know if any of you want to say anything about where we're at in terms of where things stand. Obviously, there has been some concerns expressed in recent years about the availability of lorry drivers from other European countries, the difficulties of crossing ports into Europe, but more generally a labour shortage in that sector. And I just wonder if you could say anything about how that impacts on agriculture, or if there are any other factors around haulage that are relevant.
Do you want to say anything, Paul, or will I go? I feel like I've done enough talking. Hauliers are absolutely critical, and I'm sure I read somewhere recently that, like farmers, their average age is not in the lower bracket, so there could be an impetus. There could be a real loss of them quite soon, I think. And livestock hauliers in particular, it's a specific role. You know, it's not something that anybody can do. Actually, most of the livestock hauliers that I've come across are Scottish. You know, the Europeans and others who've come and driven lorries for supermarkets and things, I don't think they've made it into the livestock haulage business, as far as I'm aware. But I suppose the lack of lorry drivers in other parts of in other sectors could be pulling people out, because you might not want to get up at 5 o'clock in the morning and go and load cattle onto a lorry in the pouring rain. You know, you might prefer to go to a distribution centre. So it is something that is a real risk. And again, there's regulation around there which is necessary, but we definitely, you know, they definitely need support to help make sure that everybody's getting through it. The real risk, and I don't know if this has gone away or not, because things have gone very quiet, is there was a consultation that DEFRA put out about transportation of animals, and there has been talk of changing particularly the headroom that is required for animals, but also temperature controls. Now, if those sort of things were, I'm not sure where they've got to, because it seems to have gone quiet, but if those things were to be brought in and suddenly hauliers were being told you need to replace your £250,000 lorry with a brand new one that's 5 inches taller because of the headroom, that's going to put a lot of people out of business. So it's things like that which are, again, done for good reason. People think they're doing the right thing, but it's looking at the unintended consequences of that sort of change that we need to be really cognizant of.
Drink of water for a minute. So I'll talk about your hauling milk in just a little bit. So I think there's a number of factors here. The factors that Kate talked about, you know, the average age. I think going back a couple of years, there was pressure. There was really a lack of pipeline of haulier drivers coming through, and what a number of milk processing companies did is they trained their office staff actually up and people who are fuel based to drive lorries just to get around that. Now, I don't think it's really had to come to that those people have had to move jobs and do that. But the thing I think specifically in Scotland is that, going back to just an earlier question, I think it was just the deputy convener questioning about the lack of processing. From a milk perspective, there's a couple of creameries on the West Coast that have closed in the last 10 years. There's one milk processing site in Aberdeen that closed in the last 10 years. So milk is getting transported for longer distances. Therefore, you're going to need more drivers from that perspective to do that, which puts an additional pressure in there. You know, the longer distances that the haulier drivers are doing from that point of view. So it's not an issue that people are screaming about right now, but it's something which is a risk. You know, going back to your first question, convener, for the industry.
Can we open up the topic more broadly about labour? Can I have your views on the current labour issues we face in agriculture and horticulture, but focusing probably on what can be done in the future through an agricultural bill to alleviate some of the issues? Joe, would you like to
kick
off?
Yeah, I mean, it's absolutely a known issue. So we're publishing or launching a new strategy, national strategy for food and drink, the industry in the summer. And as part of that, we've gone around the country to gather views from different people, different businesses. And one of the top priorities is around labour shortages, labour skills. We know that some of those issues are being looked at by the Migration Advisory Committee, and they're continuing their work around the shortage occupation list and potential. There's movement there around who can we potentially bring in to Scotland to fill those labour gaps. There are also other work, like, for example, DEFRA, John Shropshire's review into labour shortages in agriculture, specifically focusing on England, but almost certainly have ramifications into Scotland as well. So there's various pieces of work, and it's clear that there is an issue, there's an ongoing issue in terms of recruiting people, especially into rural areas. We've got examples of members who are busing busloads of workers from urban areas into rural areas to do a day's work, and you know, taking measures such as that just demonstrates the nature of the issue and the problem that I think we face here. And it's compounded, as I understand it, by not just a labour shortage, but accommodation for those labourers given. Things like Airbnb and the ease of which it is now to rent out accommodation that previously wouldn't have really been viable as an economic input. So that kind of almost presents it as problems rather than solutions, but there is work underway to review and see what can be done. And clearly, if there is opportunities within this bill to help fill those gaps and help businesses to fill those gaps and continue to produce, because we know that sometimes they're turning away orders because they just don't have the labour there. And automation plays a part in all of this as well, but automation requires investment. It isn't just simply feasible for an individual business to invest the amounts needed often to turn that particular production section into something that's automated.
Can I ask, Paul, you're specifically around the dairy industry. We've seen some dairy managers changing the working week for dairymen. We know that it's a hard task. Milking cows have been there, done that. But we are seeing different practices. From your perspective, how can labour shortages be addressed in the future?
Yes, yeah, so you're right. It's particularly challenging, and there are a number of farmers looking at, you know, different contracts that fit around individuals they can bring on, and we've got challenges in terms of farmers almost poaching people from, you know, from the neighbouring farm, which obviously causes some issues. There's a number of farms which are just almost solely relying on family labour. Now the challenge with that is, that's a knock-on effect to mental health. But even from, if we think of this policy that we're talking about from a Scottish Government perspective, if we want farmers to pick up, to learn about this and to learn what they can do, we know when we do meetings, the farmers learn best from other farmers. So it's getting along to meetings, meeting other farmers. If you're stuck in the farm and you're not getting off there, and you're trying to learn about, you know, climate change mitigation or biodiversity online and looking at a webinar meeting, that's fine. But the best way to learn is by seeing things in practice. So I think there's a number of issues that this is causing, and I think right now there's probably no solution. There are some farms that actually don't have a go on social media quite a bit. I don't have an issue with people coming through the door, but there's a number of other farms that are really finding this very, very difficult. And it gets to the point of, you know, the average age of farmers, how long can you keep going on your own, or how long can you keep going just with family labour, when you're actually having to milk, you know, two and sometimes three times a day, it just becomes impossible.
Jim Fairley.
Yeah. Are we still on labour, yeah? Yes.
No, natural impacts, unless you've got a supplementary.
Well, I've got a sup on labour, if that's OK.
Yeah, OK, and then I'll bring Christina.
You asked the panel about whether or not we can do anything with this bill. Now, given that Brexit is clearly the biggest cause of the lack of labour coming into the country that we had previously, how does this bill alter any of that, given that immigration is reserved?
I suppose I meant the indirect consequence, if we're talking about an agriculture policy for Scotland, mm-hmm. and as part of the agriculture policy for Scotland, you're going to need farmers to understand what they can do from a climate mitigation perspective or biodiversity. The way to learn, the best way for those farmers to learn on that process would be actually to come to meetings. Now, my specific point was, if they're stuck on the farms because they haven't got the because they haven't got labour, they can't attend the meetings, and therefore their ability to pick up the intelligence on that and the learnings and actually implement it back in their own farm will be restricted.
Okay, Kate.
Yeah, so I suppose from my point of view, it's two different things. You've got the more intensive sectors like dairy, like soft fruit, where you need seasonal workers to come in, and that's the point.
But we also need capacity in processing and slaughtering, and a lot of these lads came from Eastern Europe, went home, and they haven't come back. So if we're talking about resilience and we're talking about profitability, we need to have people in those jobs. But the Scottish Government has no locus on any of the immigration policies, so how does this bill rectify that issue?
So the bill, I would say, from my uninformed point of view, that the bill can't rectify that because that is reserved. But what the other side of that, apart from these people that we need to come in, excuse me, to help our processing and our areas, we also need to have people in this country who want to go into food and farming, and we need to do what the bill, in my view, could do is promote confidence in those sectors to
encourage more people from this country to go into those sectors, because it's not just those sectors that are struggling. I was up in Caithness in the summer. Farmers there were telling me that they were giving up, they were selling up their cattle. It wasn't anything to do with financial, or not all to do with financial. It was to do with the fact that they were getting older. There was nobody they could get locally to come and help them to do a TB test or to PD their cattle or whatever they needed. It was the skills that were there on the ground. And that isn't Eastern Europeans or Filipinos coming in. That's people in this country. So I think we've got to start at the bottom up. We've got to make sure that we work in schools to let kids know that this is an option for them, to make it as welcoming as possible, to try and get people to come in from out with the farming sector, but also to make it as easy as possible for our own children in the farming sector to carry on, and to make them want to carry on, so that we've got those people coming through. And we need to make sure that things like skills and education are designed around rural communities, as well as being designed around going to university. So if you don't want to go off to university, there is an opportunity to go somewhere local and learn. And that's colleges like SRUC, it's things like Monitor Farms, that's the sort of thing Paul was talking about that we do. It's giving them opportunities, the Farm Advisory Service, to get out there and learn in the community that they're in, and not saying you have to go off to university. So to me, they're two different sides, and you're right. I don't know what this bill can do about the Brexit side of that, but we can certainly do something about promoting confidence in the whole sector using the bill.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. On that point, I think the new industry strategy is looking for responsible growth, and responsible growth is about economic prosperity and having vibrant, viable communities across Scotland with food and drink at the heart, and food and drink productivity, profitability and sustainability. And if we achieve that, then it should become more attractive as a sector for our domestic workforce. That doesn't solve everything, but the bill could potentially support that.
Thank you. Christine Graham.
Yes, on local, I'm just going to pick up something that was said there on local employment. I think it was the NFUS that ran something, a Borders Union showground last year, where all the local schools came, and they had, big fancy tractors and sheep shearing, but they also, to get children locally interested in the farming sector broadly. And the college also, Borders College, also had a stall. Did you know about that? And what I was going to ask you is, if you didn't, I don't know why not, but secondly, would it be worth us going back, convener, to the NFUS, who I think were promoting it, to ask the outcome, because that's to stimulate local children's interest in the sector, and also the college, whether the college had any feedback from that. It was a really good day.
So that's the Border Union who run that day.
So it was a Border Union?
It's the Border Union Agricultural Society, I think, who run that day, and they've been doing it for a while, because my daughter, they take the primary sixes, every primary six
That's
in
right.
the Borders is invited, five, is it five, to go on that day, to the countryside day. And my daughter's now 24 and she went. So they've been doing it for a good long time. And it's Rhett are very involved as well. QMS go along and help all the different, NFUS
yes.
too. It is something that happens in the Borders. I don't know if it happens elsewhere, but it's a really, really good
I'm just asking for the outcome, really. It's an interesting day, but, do people actually take up careers in agriculture, horticulture? I'm interested in seeing what impact it has.
It would be interesting. I don't know if they have any information on that, but it'd be interesting to follow that up. I suppose you're talking about 10-year-olds, and then you need to really speak to them again in probably 10 years' time to see if that had
well,
any
been
effect
going all
on
that
them.
Time, we must have some already. Your
yeah, there must be. There
24,
must. There so must be. We could certainly see if there's any.
So, could I ask you, convener, if you can maybe do a follow-up and see what, if an audit, what happened at the end of this? What follow-up mm-hmm. there was mm-hmm. from Borders Union and from the college, who also have a stall there.
Yep.
It seems to me that is an interesting way forward for local employment. You employ people locally; yep. they spend locally.
Joe and then Paul.
It was just to touch on the work of developing the young workforce programmes across Scotland and the fact that they are seeking to hold these sorts of engagement events and have been quite forthcoming towards Scotland Food and Drink around how can we get more people, processors, primary producers involved in those sorts of events. So I'd say that that is absolutely an opportunity for us to improve the level of awareness and understanding of the kind of opportunities for careers in this sector.
Yeah, and I think from my perspective, as well as Rhett, that there's a number of things that we do, and I think QMS are involved in terms of speaking to teachers about the role of meat and dairy and talking about the careers in there. And we also run a consumer campaign, We Eat Balance, which talks about the role of meat and dairy and which is aimed at anybody that watches TV or looks at social media across a certain period and is in retail. So there's a number of places we'll raise awareness on meat and dairy from a career perspective. Yeah, it'd be interesting to see what the Borders Union say, and particularly Rhett, say on that, because they'd be the leaders.
Yeah, certainly Royal Highland Educational Trust do a huge amount of good work. And I'm pleased to say they'll be coming into Parliament at some time soon to educate the MSPs. Some who, I'm not going to suggest they need educated, but it certainly would open their eyes to some of the issues we face in the rural agricultural sector. Moving on, Jim Fairley.
Thanks very much, Convener. I want to talk about natural impacts, weather, pests, stuff like that. Now, from a livestock producer's point of view, there's a phrase that the Galloway Society brought out a couple of years ago, the future is traditional. In terms of the native breeds, their ability to outwinter, if we're talking about resilience and profitability, that kind of comes back to my question I asked you about earlier on. What are we judging on, eating quality or shape? So what role do you see the sort of traditional native breeds, and sorry, I'm focusing this on cattle and sheep again, what role do you see the traditional native breeds taking in making sure that we have long-term profitability and going back to the old traditional native breeds?
So breeds are very much an individual decision for each farmer to make. But what we are seeing in the national picture is that the native breed sired calves are going up. There are more Aberdeen Anguses and Shorthorns and Herefords, all those sort of things. The numbers of them are going up. And, if you go back in time, we've sent these genetics around the world. All the cattle that you get from South America are from those genetics. So it's very, very important. What we can't do as Quality Meat Scotland is tell people you should have this breed or that breed. Or as government, what we can do is show them the benefits of the characteristics that different breeds have, and then people make up their own mind depending on the situation in their farm. So I would absolutely agree that they're a great selling point. Things, people, Aberdeen Angus in particular is recognised worldwide, and the numbers of Aberdeen Angus sired calves are going up year on year.
Very disappointed you don't mention Galloway there, Kate.
Sorry.
I do like my Galloway cattle. Sorry, I know that I was very specific. Is there anything else that any of the rest of you want to talk about in terms of natural issues? Like, where, again, I go back to weather because traditional breeds will winter out better rather than being in sheds. Anything else the rest of the panel want to add to that?
No, I don't think so at this point.
I think what we wanted to get your views on, can you see anything in the future around natural impacts, so the changes in weather, or increase in pests, that's something that we need to be aware of and potentially consider as part of the bill?
Risk management involves or requires capacity to understand and then measure and mitigate for that risk. So the bill could presumably provide some of that capacity as a system-wide, because the risks exist across all points of the supply chain for all producers, processors, and etc. Within the kind of weather changes, climate change will probably drive different weather patterns, and we'll have to respond to that as well. But there's geopolitical, there's environmental. All those risks have to be essentially monitored, managed, and then addressed. So it's the capacity for that is probably one of the key elements of resilience.
This very nicely onto geopolitical and environmental risks. Ariane Burgess.
Thanks, Convener. Yeah, so I wanted to look at that in the future, geopolitical and environmental risks in the future. And I'm going to direct this question to you, Joe. But given the risks of trade deals like those with Australia and New Zealand undermining food production to higher environmental standards that we've been discussing, those standards in Scotland, do you think that there's a need for something like a carbon border adjustment mechanism, which the EU is bringing in to increase the price of imported goods from countries where carbon taxes are not in place? And do we need a similar mechanism to increase the price of meat and other food products imported from countries with lower environmental and animal welfare standards?
It's difficult to talk about specific mechanisms. I don't, you know, fully know all the consequences of each one. But it is absolutely true to say that if you're producing a premium product and then that the price of that product is undercut by imports due to trade agreements, then you are threatening the viability of the domestic production. And some form of protection is needed there. What that form takes could differ depending on what decisions are made. The trade agreements that are being made are of concern, I would say, in terms of understanding them. They're complicated. We don't yet fully understand the opportunities they might present, as well as the threats that they might present. And we're engaging Scottish Government around that specifically, because there's a lot of them happening, a lot of them in discussion. And we had a very effective trade agreement when we were a member of the European Union, which has obviously been dismantled and unpicked, and there are complications and challenges around supplying into our nearest neighbour. So that is absolutely, you know, a critical factor and something that we will need to monitor and watch, and it does present a threat. And diversified markets is one of the potential solutions for that, in terms of making sure that we have a diverse range of people and places that buy Scottish produce.
Thanks very much for that response. So I'm just curious to know, Kate or Paul, if you've got any thoughts, not necessarily specifically on that bit around carbon border adjustments, but just trade agreements or anything that you think in the future that we need to be aware of that could be coming our way.
Do you want to go first? I'll come after you.
I think it's important with the carbon that everybody's playing on this, you know, it's on a level playing field. It would be absolutely wrong of us to cut down domestic production and then just bring in food from somewhere else and pretend that it didn't matter because it was somebody else that was producing it. So I think that's really, really important. I think also it's very important that we have mechanisms in place to make sure that disease is not brought into this country. And I think there needs to be a huge investment in that, and that's not necessarily this Parliament's issue, that's maybe UK. But it's all very well saying we've got these checks in place, but they need to be actually being done for it to matter. And I think there was a recent case where there was lorries coming in and only one of them out of 22 was even looked at. And the big current issue is African swine fever. If it came into this country, it would be absolutely devastating to our pig industry. But as the climate changes, that could be any number of different diseases. So we need to make sure, from a biosecurity point of view, that that's done. On an export level, there are huge opportunities out there in the world for our producers. I would definitely echo what the other two have said about how that can help our domestic market and help the primary producer. So we do international trade shows, and it does help also that international export trade to balance carcasses with red meat. So there's a lot of things in an animal that we don't want to eat in this country. I've seen some things that they really like to eat in places like China and Indonesia and places, but we would not touch them with a barge pole. So it's very, very important that we have that carcass balance, and we can sell the things that other people want, absolutely, to them, and we can bring in anything that we need extra that we haven't got the capacity to produce. You know, lambs have only got two back legs, so you've got to make sure that balance works, and exports are really, really important, but it has to be done on a level playing field.
Just to come in on that point, so as my organisation is a non-departmental public body, so I'll be skating thin ice if I talk about policy. But from an evidence perspective, I think it's an interesting question in terms of carbon border adjustments and different policies of different organisations. And it'd be something I'd be happy to commit to doing some analysis on that and sharing with the committee there.
Thanks very much for that.
Thank you. Alistair Allen.
Thank you, Convener. In talking about future risks, geopolitical risks that we face, everybody quite rightly points to the shock to the agricultural economy worldwide that the illegal invasion of Ukraine has represented, but we have to be prepared for other potential shocks in future. So despite the fact that obviously, regrettably, this Parliament can't legislate on some of the problems that we've just been talking about, I just wonder if you can say a bit more about how resilient Scotland is to future shocks, what those shocks might look like, and where the role of labour shortage is in all that and being resilient to future shocks.
Well, I mean, again, the risks and sort of resilience issue is complicated. The risks exist, you know, almost everywhere across the supply chain, and because we're talking about a natural product, we're talking about variance in weather being hugely critical to that. We have to provide protection for our primary producers and for the rest of the supply chain. As an island nation, we also have to recognise that industrial unrest will sometimes cause blockages at ports, and for perishable goods, that's a short-term acute situation which we have to have some form of mitigation against. So all I would do really in response to this is echo what I said previously, which is that if you have a risk capacity within the country to understand what's happening, and we obviously have a task force now set up which we're part of and is looking at things like food security. Those sorts of mechanisms are really important to ensure that there's eyeballs on the situation and something there to call upon in terms of support to overcome that headwind. And we've had major headwinds for some time and they continue. So, you know, we need to build resilience in the short term across the industry, and then we can look forward to, you know, hopefully a future which is kind of bright.
Should government underwrite the production of certain crops? So some crops that are more risky to grow but actually should form part of our future food supply. Should government underwrite those, like an insurance policy against the more frequent natural weather patterns that make growing some cereals more difficult? Is that something that the policy should consider?
Well, I think the policy probably has to consider all forms of investment from the public fund into agriculture. And where that lies, you know, there is not a limitless pot. So difficult decisions have to be made, I would imagine, around what do we support, what do we provide into. The NFUS has been quite clear, and I think we would support this, and the Cabinet Secretary has also said, you know, active farming, you know, productive farming is something we can all get behind, we can all be proud of, in line with our, you know, environmental constraints, in line with our social aims and ambitions around vibrant communities. All of those things are possible, but there is a, you know, difficult balance in terms of what do we use the public funding that we put into that to achieve, and that obviously partly comes down to decisions made at UK government level as well. So uncertainty, unfortunately, is something that we have to live with.
Yeah, just on that point, I mean, you mentioned uncertainty and you mentioned the UK government, which are often mentioned in the same sentence. And I just wonder if you feel that, as organisations, I wonder if you are making representations to the UK government about preparing for geopolitical shocks in the future, and whether you feel it would be useful if some of the relevant powers might be exercised here. That's a hopeful last question, but I'll put it anyway.
So as an NDPB also, we are not a lobby organisation, but we absolutely are speaking to people at both levels of government to provide information and make sure that they know the facts about red meat production in Scotland. That's probably all I can say.
Thank you.
Likewise, we have conversations with a wide range of stakeholders. We have a membership group. We also are a leadership body. We coordinate the Scotland Food and Drink Partnership. We're responsible in part for driving forward this new industry strategy. Some of that strategy to be successful does require decisions to be made at UK government level, and we will engage around that to try and ensure that the sector as a whole, the industry as a whole, can grow responsibly, with both parts of that being really important, growth and responsibility.
Yeah, okay. And again, for us, it would be the same. We're providing evidence to government rather than lobbying area.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Beatrice Wishart.
Thanks, Convener. And I guess my question follows on from what's just been discussed before, and it's looking at what the actual priorities you would see being required from agriculture and food policy today, just to mitigate some of those risks and ensure the long-term resilience. Are there any priorities that you would like to see?
So the three priorities that we would have would be, as I've already gone through, local public procurement and making sure local and public, which are two different things, I suppose. There are various things that could be done in public procurement, a streamlined process, a framework that everybody worked to would be really useful. The infrastructure that you need for that local procurement piece is really important. Labour and skills is hugely influential in how we go forward, and help with international exports. Those are the things that we would really see as being priorities.
Joe?
So we really want to ensure that Scotland maintains its international reputation as a producer of world-class food and drink. And to ensure that and help protect that, we need to work together, we need to collaborate, we need to continue the dialogue. Sometimes these difficult decisions will need to be made, and we will recognise, you know, across the industry, the need to act swiftly to address the climate challenge, nature crises. But it's one thing that's absolutely clear to us is that food production needs to be at the heart of the industry, it needs to be at the heart of agriculture, and that's how we can protect the jobs, the communities, the ecosystem that is supported by and supports the food and drink sector industry.
And I think the only thing I would add in this, and this is maybe related, is how the policy lands with farmers and how the engagement with farmers, particularly around about this, is done. And we did some analysis on the sustainable farming incentives. I appreciate this is DEFRA when they did it. And I think what the key message out of that was the higher payment rates were needed to incentivise farmers to take part in some schemes. So in terms of thinking about, you know, new policy development, the key things for us would be, you know, ease of application for farmers, ease of operation of the scheme, attractiveness of the payment rates, confidence of the participants in the audits and inspections, and any you know, additionality gained from participation, you know, specifically around about that. So we have, in the same way as QMS have, we've got expertise in terms of engaging farmers, primarily around farmer-to-farmer learning through the groups that we've done. So it's about, you know, using that expertise, using the industry to come together with one voice, and certainly from a dairy industry perspective, from the roadmap, the environmental roadmap that's been in place, which is probably further ahead than other sectors. There's a lot of learnings there we can use in terms of getting farmers to move along certain lines there.
Thank you.
Ariane Burgess.
Thanks. So, Kate, I'm going to direct this question to you first. I'd be interested to hear what the risks are to meat production. We've talked about the processing issues, but specifically in relationship to climate change.
So I suppose the biggest risk at the moment is that we go down the wrong route in our efforts to tackle it. And as we said right at the beginning, nobody is arguing that we don't need to do something, but we need to make sure that we go down the right routes and don't end up, I've said it several times, with unintended consequences. It's so important that we keep people in rural areas. It's important from an economic point of view and a societal point of view, and also from an environmental point of view, because if the people aren't there, they're not going to be able to take the actions that we need them to take. And I just wanted to bring up, I know you've spoken to Martin Kennedy from NFUS. He has started talking about support or subsidy in terms of investment. He's no longer calling it subsidy or support. He's calling it investment, because that is absolutely what it is. Any public money that's going into agriculture is an investment. It's an investment in society, in rural economies. It's an investment in our future health, in our food security. And it's so, so important that we keep that investment going to make sure that we have the confidence in the sector that we need for it to continue, because that is another big risk, is that people don't have confidence, farmers don't have confidence. And as I said a few weeks ago when I was here, they feel absolutely browbeaten down. And if that lack of confidence is there, then that is a huge risk to the sector. So that's what I would say.
Thanks for that. So in terms of confidence, so last week we had Ian Boyd Livingston at the panel, and he was talking about the need for investment. I think I'll start using that word, investment, for livestock farmers who want to diversify their income streams or transition to low stock or no stock farming. And I'd be interested to hear from you, what kind of investment do you think we need for those farmers who want to make that transition and take those steps for that diversification, around moving to that low stock farming, or want to move towards different forms of environmental land management?
So I would say most farmers, for a start, not many farmers I know want to leave livestock production. They want to continue with it. They want to be able to do it profitably, and they want it to work for their business, but also for their farms. Lots of farmers are diversifying, and it's a new word, or a newish word, but it's not a new concept. Farmers have always done everything it takes to be able to make a living and to be able to stay on their farm. You know, 50 years ago, my dad had a trout farm on our farm, which gave us a little bit of extra pocket money. It's long gone now because of regulation, but we need to help farmers if that's what they want to do, if they want to diversify. So agritourism, all those sorts of things should be supported. But at the bedrock of it all is the actual farming life that they have, and the business that they have. And we just need to make sure... It's a very emotional subject, actually, because farmers love, as I said before, farmers love their farms. They love farming. We're there because we love it. We love producing food for people. We love being in the countryside. We love looking after nature. And we just need to make sure, policy-wise, that people are enabled to do that. And farmers have always adapted. They've always done extra things, and they will do it if they're given that help. So it's about education. It's about support, it's about investment, and it's about the policy direction to show that they're valued and that they're important in the rural economy.
And I'm picking up from some of what you're saying in that passionate response, and I certainly meet farmers who also express that love for the work that they're doing. But I'm also hearing some of what you talked about earlier around the peer-to-peer learning and the monitor farms and that kind of thing, where people can get out and learn about new practices or different ways of doing things from each other.
Yeah, and that's so, so important, because it is an isolating industry. There are, you know, I've just gone through 4 weeks where I've not left the farm at all. You don't see people. There are lots of farms out there who that, you know, that happens most of the year. It's not just at this time of year. So it's very, very important that those skills and that education is shared, and peer-to-peer is the best way to do it. It has been proven. And we work very closely with AHDB to run the monitor farms and to make sure that we facilitate that wherever possible.
I'm just unfortunate enough to remind everybody we're fast running out of time. We've really only got 5-10 minutes left. So if we can try and keep the questions and the responses as succinct as possible. Rachel Hamilton.
Still on the subject of mitigating risk and promoting food resilience, my question really is, how is your organisation modelling for the future using technology and innovation in agriculture to increase GDP and also reduce emissions. And bearing in mind that the Scottish Government are looking to reduce emissions in agriculture by 2032 by 31%, and so far that has not made much progress. Can I start with Paul?
I think the best route to do that is through the roadmaps we're doing. As I indicated there earlier, the dairy roadmap is probably the ones the most established, been around since 2008. In terms of getting together the industry, and what we have there is that we have our organisation AHDB, we have the processor organisation Dairy UK, and we have the farming unions working together on that. And underneath that, you've got a whole range of stakeholders working there with one aim. I would acknowledge it is easier in the dairy industry because it's a more consolidated industry, because you can work with a smaller number of processors. You know, the two largest processors have probably got over 50% of the milk in Great Britain. So you can get people together more, and then you can work through the processes to get to the farmers and get our organisations together. But that, I think that's going to be the main route we will actually achieve progress, so that everybody's behind the one plan and understands the what we're doing from a climate perspective, what we're doing from a biodiversity point of view. But at its base has to be the economics. You know, if it doesn't work for farmers to produce milk, then we won't have milk, and we'll have to import it. And Kate's point about the fabric of society as well. So I think that is a model, and I know it's happening in the beef and sheep sector as well. There's roadmaps and various working groups coming together, but that is the way we will create progress. And of course, government has got a role on that, but industry, I think, really needs to lead on that in terms of those roadmaps and drive that forward. And that will give us the confidence in terms of delivering and having the risk maps on that, and the mitigation techniques within the roadmaps, and having efficient roadmaps, and having allocating required level of resources behind them.
You do realise that you just milked some cows then? Kate, can I ask you?
So did you.
Back later.
So much like HDB, we have a Red Meat Net Zero roadmap in production, which is looking at everything from primary production right through to processors to see where to do life cycle analysis, to see where the gaps are and what we know and what we need to know. And I suppose the other part of what QMS does is help to share the sort of science and the research. We don't do it. Others do it, SRUC amongst lots and lots of others, but part of our route is to try and share that and to try and get those new practices, or some would say old practices, come back again, get those out there, get them more widely understood, and make sure farmers know exactly what they're doing and what they're being asked to do and how they do it. So that's part of our work, and the Monitor Farms are a big part of that and sharing the information.
Okay.
Joe. Very briefly, I don't know if I mentioned we have a new industry strategy being launched in the summer, but within that there are some pillars, some key pillars of work, and one of those is net zero and sustainability. And this industry strategy has been signed up and supported by all elements of the industry, including agriculture. So there is clearly a pathway, a delivery plan that will follow, that will allow us to reduce those emissions. With regards emissions as a whole for Scotland, you know, renewable energy is a massive one for the industry. We are energy intensive, and we are necessarily energy intensive. If we can reduce the carbon footprint of our grid energy, then we will massively move towards net zero. Regards meat, it's very complicated, but if we displace those emissions to other countries' production, we'll shoot ourselves in the foot.
Convener, just on this, because none of you have really answered the question specifically about what is being done from the organisations to support farmers to work out how we reach that point, because so far we've kind of got anecdotal information about route maps and about a strategic review, and unfortunately farmers are being asked to put all the eggs in one basket, and we are scrutinising this. And farmers are feeling under pressure from the expectation that they are to be part of meeting net zero by 2045. Now, as far as I can see in the pre-legislative scrutiny so far, We haven't got to the stage where there is a clear indication of what farmers can practically do with support from organisations and the government to actually get to that point. And it seems as though, as I say, they are under pressure and that everyone expects a lot of them to get to that point. And I don't know if you understand where I'm coming from there, Kate.
Yeah, I do. I think there's a lot of measures that the farmer-led groups in particular put together that but there's no if you add A, B, C, D, E, you're going to get to F. I think that's the problem. Is that what you're trying to articulate? That we don't actually know if we do all these things. Yeah. I think a big part of it is how things are accounted for. The sequestration has already been mentioned. It's not necessarily all being counted. If it is being counted, it's in different parts of the inventory. And I think what government can do is bring all that together at an individual farm level to say, look, these are the good things that you're doing. This is your positive budget. Here are the things that you can do better. And these are going to give you this saving, this saving, this saving. You're either hitting it or you're doing better than we're asking you to do, or you're not quite there. So here's some other options. Is that what you mean? An actual? So to me, that needs to be at a farm level, really. It needs to be that down there. And we need people who know what they're talking about to help farmers with that. And I'd hesitate, you know, there's been a lot of accusations about consultants' charters, and we definitely don't want that. But we do, on the other hand, need the expertise to help them. So we'd have to try and get that balance right somehow.
Just very briefly. So I agree with Kate. I mean, it needs to be baseline at the farm level, and we've done that on a number of our farms. We've got strategic dairy farms. We've got AgriCalc is the tool we use, the SRUC tool. We get somebody in there to do that, and then we look at mitigation measures underneath. Now, I can send a whole heap of, I'll try to be succinct, but the information in terms of what we're doing as the HDB, but what we're doing at individual farm levels on that. But it really has to be individual farm levels rather than national level and international levels on that. And that's the way we'll make progress and then go back and do testing a number of years later to see what progress we've made.
Mm. Yeah, I think that would be helpful. We're running out of time here, but if you're able to provide some real-life examples of what farmers are doing on the ground right now and written evidence, that would be hugely useful. Christine Graham.
Yes, thank you very much. Very interesting session. You're facing collectively a perfect storm, as you know, Brexit, COVID, Ukraine, climate change, food inflation about 18% or so. However, I'm going to cheer you up. Out of adversity comes opportunity. And I think this is a big opportunity across the sector to drive more the consumer towards more seasonal local produce. I heard what you said about the supermarkets and I understand why you might be cagey about them, but supermarkets are key. The consumers can influence, but supermarkets are very clever at influencing the consumer. So what should we ask the supermarkets? And are you going to be frank about it?
I think this is one for Joe.
Oh, thank you. it's very difficult, isn't it, to tell a major retailer what
no,
to do.
No, it isn't. Please do it, because I'm a consumer. I want to do this.
Yes.
I can afford to pay the inflation prices for my normal, but I look at the prices on the shelves, mm-hmm. and even I say I'm not paying £1.50 for a cauliflower. Mm-hmm. No? So,
yeah, well, I mean, we have, so some retailers are our members as well. We look across the whole of the food and drink system around this, and we work with them and encourage them and run programs where we meet the buyer, meet the supplier, to bring them together and create that relationship. And that does help to ensure that there is local product on local shelves. They will always be mindful, I think, of the end price, and as will consumers. And so the piece around cost of living, availability, accessibility, affordability of food, i.e. among our communities, is paramount to resolve this as well. And that is something that I think, you know, we touch on a lot in terms of resolving symptoms rather than resolving root problems. And one of the root problems that we potentially have to resolve in this country is inequality and lack of resource among communities to afford the things that we would like them to
afford. Yeah, but I want to get back to seasonal.
Yes.
Because there's no point in buying tomatoes that are rock hard, which they are, mm-hmm. plums which are rock hard.
Yeah.
So we've got, in a way, if we get back to seasonal, Scottish seasonal mm-hmm. foods or UK seasonal foods, mm-hmm. we educate the palate mm-hmm. of the consumer once again. You shouldn't be eating strawberries in January. There's the food miles and the taste crap. So can I ask what your discussions with supermarkets mm-hmm. who do bog off on these non-seasonal products, mm-hmm. whereas the Scottish mince or the cauliflowers or whatever they're growing mm-hmm. are quite dear.
Mm-hmm. Well,
so how do we have a go at them?
I would just say it's a collaborative effort. You know, we have a food and drink system, which is what it is. We start from this point now, and we move forward towards what we hope will be more resilient supply chains. We need a strong domestic market.
Yes.
We need UK market, and we need international markets. We need to diversify them. We need to produce that. Now, if we need to look at the balance of what we produce to ensure that we can supply those markets seasonally to the volumes that they need, and at the right price that we need, then we all have to play a part in that, because it comes down to what funding are we putting in place, what structures do we have in place, what regulation do we have in place, what decisions are consumers making about the food that they eat and drink. And we believe if we get that right, we have the opportunity to genuinely be proud of the food that we're producing and consuming. Public procurement, as Kate touched on, is a huge part of that. We've been trying to crack that through Food for Life Scotland. You know, but local authorities have public procurement systems which are set up still to weight towards cost. And lowest cost, if you chase the lowest cost, you are unlikely to drive up supply of Scottish. So how do we fix that in the public sector? We probably can. In the private sector, in the commercial world of supermarkets, it's more challenging. But we're absolutely on the side of wanting to champion Scottish produce.
To say the corporate body here has worked. I'm on the corporate body. We do push local produce, which is in our what I call it, the canteen, and also in the dining room. But I'm just the last point, because you haven't really... I sort of want to really know... The supermarkets do not push local produce. It's there... Mm-hmm. But it's not pushed in the same way as other items. And how can we then get them, in their part, appreciating that if the price of cauliflower, which I think is in season just now, mm-hmm. why is it so dear?
Yeah.
You know, how do we get them to say, well, actually, these are better things for you to eat, actually, than to spend your money on the stuff that's imported, that's out of season?
I mean, that's probably the million-dollar question in terms of... it's food. You're talking about food culture... You're talking about decisions that people make, private businesses making. You know, we hope that the new industry strategy will drive a conversation so we can improve that situation. We want to improve that situation as well. I'm not going to hammer supermarkets in this forum in order to drive them to change the way they operate. I think those discussions will need to continue, and we will, of course, support continued, you know, local domestic supply into those retailers. But those retailers are, at the moment, absolutely critical to providing food and drink to our communities and our people.
Yeah, as I say, we'll probably get a chance to look at this again, the Good Food Nation. Last but not least, Karen Adam.
Thank you, Convener. And I think a lot of my questions have been answered throughout this session, so I might throw in a wild card, but not too wild, Convener, if I may. But just, you know, after hearing all the evidence thus far, just to touch upon, Kate, what you said early on in the session in regards to France and how they spend a bit more, you know, on their food and things. And it just got my brain thinking, you know, that obviously they don't have as high energy costs as we might have. And our everyday lives, maybe commute costs. I don't know. There might have to be, you know, some kind of report maybe commissioned just to find out why there is more spend on food and why we can't often pay more. But there's this constant dichotomy almost between profitability and affordability. And this just keeps coming up all the time. And if we were to focus more on a health and well-being economy, where we're actually looking at perhaps low-carbon foods, where there's perhaps a levy on high carbon footprints, so if something is being imported that would generally be cheaper, it might cost more because it's got higher carbon footprint, lower carbon footprint, local, you know, maybe there is some government support there for lower carbon. You know, these are the things... If we were to flip around and really look at a health and wellbeing economy where we're including environmental, where we're including people's good mental health, producing food locally with great employee benefits. Also, I know that fishing was mentioned and the ports. There's quite a high cost to people landing their fish in the northeast at the ports as well, which they have to
focus on agriculture.
So it's I'm just trying to wrap it up in a way that if we are focusing on a health and wellbeing economy rather than just these profits, would that make a big difference to the industry and what we're doing?
And then last word to Kate.
Yeah, I suppose very briefly on that, I see where you're coming from, and I think we'd have to think about how we would model that. My concern with it is what percentage of the population would that, if you float all that, would actually be able to pay for that, when you're going through a cost of living crisis and what you do, because we have to have one eye, and when we sell stuff, it'd be nice that we got twice the money for it, but, for doing certain things. But we need to be able to serve the needs of the consumer. So I think it's something that's worth thinking about. But yeah, we'd have to do some modelling on that in terms of how would we segment the population to pay for that.
Yeah, thank you.
I think we focus on responsible growth, and both parts of that are really important. And responsibility encompasses sustainability. I think with meat and dairy, it's a contentious topic, and there are very intelligent people arguing for different perspectives, different solutions. We would there are models and systems around sustainable food systems which use ruminants as part of that sustainable food system, and we would advocate for farming to support productive agriculture. And if we get those decisions right, then it will affect how we use our land, it will affect how we farm, how we produce, but it will also touch on how we sell, how we trade internationally, and what we eat as a country. And that demand for different foods from different consumers at the retail level is an important part of that mix. Whether you would want to put a carbon price against something when that's a single vision, a single lens, if you like, looking at that. There are other factors. And, we haven't really touched on the fact that, well, we have briefly, actually, the fact that the meat and dairy agriculture exists in Scotland on land which is otherwise unsuitable for many forms of agriculture. That is part of our mix and not part of our consideration here, as is the fact that if you took away fossil fuel use, which is obviously driving climate change, and that is about our energy and our transport sectors, you probably wouldn't be looking at agriculture at all in terms of its climate change impact, because it's part of a methane cycle rather than using fossil fuels by and large. So there's a lot of factors at play here, which I think we need to consider. But if we get it right, we can all be rightly proud of the food we're producing, what we're eating in Scotland.
Thanks, John.
And Kate?
I think you're right about we need to have a health and wellbeing at our core. That's what we need to be focusing on as a society. But for farmers, a lot of their health and wellbeing is down to the need to be profitable as well. So the two things are completely entwined. And they need to be profitable not just financially, but they also need to make sure that the environment and society and everything are also in that profitable category as well. And I just wanted to end with talking about the French example. So at the NFU conference a few years ago, there was a French lady there, and she was speaking about food. She was from the Ministry of Agriculture, speaking about food, and she was talking about all the things they do in France. And one of the farmers put up a hand and asked a question. He said, how can we get our society to value food and local food in the same way that they do in France? And she didn't understand the question, because to her, it wasn't something you got people to do. It was just how you were. It was just part of you that's what you did. She didn't understand. She was, that's just how you do it, So she didn't understand the question, and it wasn't the language barrier, because that's in their society and in their psyche. And to me, that's where we need to get to. And that all starts with education and with children and with moving things slowly in that direction towards that health and wellbeing economy.
Thank you.
Thank you very much for your extended but hugely valuable contribution this morning. That's been fascinating, and it will certainly help us in our deliberations when we get the bill before us. So thank you very much for joining us this morning. I will now suspend this meeting until 11 a.m. Welcome back, everybody. Our next item of business this morning is consideration of petition PE1758, End Greyhound Racing in Scotland. And welcome to the meeting Paul Brignall, the owner and director of Thornton Greyhounds, Mark Bird, the Chief Executive Officer, and Professor Madeleine Campbell, both an independent director, both of the Greyhound Board of Great Britain. We have around about 75 minutes for questions and discussion, and I'd like to invite all our contributors and witnesses to give a short opening statement. I'll start with Paul.
Good morning. At the moment, Thornton Greyhound Track is the only one operating in Scotland. We race approximately 40 meetings per year, where on average 30 greyhounds will race in 5 or 6 races. The greyhounds race against each other for their enjoyment and ours, and it is safer for a greyhound to run around our safety prepared sand track than it is to run around a field where uneven ground and rabbit holes can be far more dangerous. I would question that any of the concerns raised by the petitioners in their previous statements to yourselves have any bearing on greyhound racing in Scotland. We have provided video evidence to show you and the SAWC that there are very few injuries at our track, and the SAWC have attended the track and seen that all the greyhounds were in excellent condition and there were no animal welfare issues. The SAWC have submitted a report to this committee which also contains very little relevance to greyhound racing in Scotland and makes a case for phasing it out based on greyhound racing in other countries. They have recommended that a vet be present at all race meetings. And whilst every animal-based sport would love to have a trained vet in attendance, the cost for amateur sport is far too high. Whilst all GBGB tracks have a vet in attendance, this is paid for by the bookmakers and funded by the multi-million pound betting industry. How do you propose that amateur greyhound racing, and for that matter, all other hobby sports involving animals competing, are going to fund a vet? In the rare event of a serious injury, there are several vet surgeries in the close vicinity of the track, and any injured greyhound will receive treatment faster than any person would get treated at accident and emergency. Even if there were a vet at the track, the injured greyhound would still have to go to a surgery because it needs to have an X-ray and operating facilities to treat it. The SAWC should give independent advice to ministers. However, their previous correspondence, their report and subsequent presentation show an unacceptable level of anti-greyhound racing sentiment. The Call for Views has given animal activists in Scotland yet another platform to attack greyhound racing. Whilst the committee maybe felt that they would get the views of the general public, this was never going to be the case. The passionate animal rights activist has far more motivation to take part in the Call for Views than any other person. And this can be seen clearly in the report as to what has happened. The Call for Views is no basis for deciding the future of greyhound racing in Scotland. The Scottish Animal Welfare Act protects all animals in Scotland, and there is no reason why a greyhound in Scotland should be treated any differently from any other animal that competes for fun and competition and recreation. Thank you very much.
Mark.
Kavina, you'd be glad to know that I'm not going to monopolise the 3 minutes that you've offered us, but thank you for allowing us to come along this morning. I just have a question, which is, Madeleine, myself, and going back to Paul's comments about the SAWC report, both gave evidence to the SAWC committee. I think we were pretty dismayed by what we then read when it was published. We have submitted a response to that, in which we outline there are over 35 inaccuracies in which we want to hopefully air today within this committee meeting. But can I just confirm that you have that report and the members of the committee have seen that?
Yes.
Thank you. That's as much time as I need. Thank you.
Yeah, we'll kick off with questions. Thank you for those opening remarks. What I would like to open with is to explore how GBGB and also Thornton protect the welfare of greyhounds through your role as a director, but the role as a nationwide organisation, and what evidence it has that the approach secures the highest level of animal welfare. For example, in your responses, if you could scope out your role and how you monitor the tracks and for GBGB, and how that data on monitoring is made available, and how you engage with the public and external organisations to incorporate expert advice. So I'll maybe kick off with Mark from the GBGB perspective, but then move on to Paul to outline how you address potential animal welfare issues.
Okay, so the Greyhound Board of Great Britain came about as a result of the Donoghue report, which was done by the Westminster government, which looked at greyhound welfare. And then subsequent to that, there was legislation laid in 2010, which obviously looked at the welfare of racing greyhounds. So all of that came into being, and GBGB became the self-appointed regulator of the sport in the UK. We're not a big organisation, we're certainly not for profit. There's 32 members of the Greyhound Board that exist, and within that we are required to, first of all, certificate and licence all the tracks, of which there are 20, but also all of the trainers and the residential kennels as well. So that's been in being since the Donoghue report was given life. And has evolved over the subsequent nearly 22 years since. So from that point of view, we have a small office in London, but most of what we do is about feet on the ground and going to the tracks, doing inspections, mostly at random, but every year a track is recertificated, and that's the case also with the trainers as well. We have 504 licensed Greyhound Board trainers, and again, their kennels will be checked twice every year as a minimum of what we're doing to try and safeguard the welfare of the greyhounds. You asked also what we do in relation to the public and other stakeholders. As well as having a stakeholder board, we also report back through DEFRA and through DCMS, but also in relation to other stakeholders. We meet with other animal welfare charities which sit under the Greyhound Forum. And that meeting still takes place. And even though, as you're probably all aware, the RSPCA Dogs Trust and Blue Cross have called for a ban on greyhound racing more widely, they are still members of the Greyhound Forum, and we continue to exist with them and to speak with them and work with them in terms of taking greyhound welfare forward.
Paul, Madeline.
If I might just add a couple of very brief comments to that. You asked about the scope of the protection which we provide for animal welfare. And as you know, we're only required to take responsibility for animal welfare within the racing period of a greyhound's life. But as you will have seen from the strategy which we published almost a year ago now, we have made a decision as the GBGB that we will take responsibility across the entirety of the life of a greyhound bred for racing, and also that we expect all stakeholders to join us in adopting that responsibility. And in terms of engagement, everything Mark said, and on top of which we're also working with the charities within the Greyhound Forum to develop kind of roadshow type events whereby alongside them we can go out and engage with the public, for example at county shows and that kind of thing, to talk about welfare and particularly as far as retired greyhounds go.
Okay, thank you. Paul, it would appear that we have the GBGB, who's almost the professional arm of greyhound racing, but from what you said in your opening statement, you're very much the amateur side. So what policies on a week-to-week basis, how do you review animal welfare concerns as part of an amateur sport?
Well, fundamentally, because we're an amateur sport, it's the actual welfare of the greyhound on a day-to-day basis is the responsibility of the owner of that greyhound. As a track, which is a hobby track, our only real responsibility is to ensure the track is as safe as possible and the environment that the greyhounds are in is as safe as possible when they come to the track. And we do that to the best of our ability. We can always improve things, but at the end of the day, I would believe if there was a dog that was coming to the track that wasn't in a good condition, we would address that, we would approach the owner, and we'd say, you're not looking after that dog properly. But that really is the scope of what the track will do for that greyhound's welfare. And fundamentally, it is the responsibility of the owner, as it is for a whippet or a dog agility dog. They turn up at events and it's their responsibility to look after that dog. And that fundamentally is where our responsibility ends, is the safety of the dog on the track.
But as a director and the owner of the track, is there a procedure you go through? Do you have a board of directors that meets on a regular basis and maybe decides that an owner has presented a dog on a regular basis which hasn't perhaps been, in your view...
Well, that's never happened, to be honest. Okay. I mean, all the people that look after their dogs at our track look after them exceedingly well, and the SAWC will confirm that. I mean, they came... Now, contrary to what they think, we didn't tell anybody at the track that they were coming, and it was purely... they turned up and everyone, the first they knew of it was when I announced it over the tannoy that the SAWC are here and we would like you to cooperate with them.
Okay.
And that was the first they knew. So what they saw was what it is on a regular basis at our track.
Okay, thank you. Ariane Burgess.
Thanks, Convener. The Scottish Animal Welfare Commission noted that racing greyhounds suffer specific injuries, particularly around the foreleg, that we do not see in other dogs, companion dogs or dogs that run but not in races. And I'd be interested to hear some more information about the type of injuries that racing greyhounds endure compared to other dogs, and if you could outline the role and importance of having vets present on the site. So maybe Madeline.
Thank you. So it's not surprising, perhaps, that canine athletes, like human athletes, incur different type injuries than non-athletes. And one of the things which the Greyhound Board was already doing and which we have continued to develop within this current welfare strategy is really to drill down into the evidence base around that. So we're working and have already worked to improve the granularity of the evidence which we collect, the data which we collect. It's sometimes difficult because the numbers are quite small, so we need to be careful that we interpret that really carefully. And exactly with that in mind, we are also in the process of recruiting a specific data analyst who can help us to do that. So what we're trying to do, of course, is to understand which type of injuries occur and then what the predisposing factors are which might result in those injuries, and that really goes across the board. So it goes to everything from track design, and there's parts around that within the strategy, to the way in which dogs are prepared for races, to detection, to the way in which people are trained to detect very early injuries so that the dogs can be rested and treated appropriately and not race. And those are subclinical injuries we're talking about. All of that is written into the strategy, as well as using new technologies. And we've got research in place around that, which will help us to make use of all of the techniques that nowadays are used in human athletes to try and adopt some of that and apply it to canine athletes as well.
And what about the role and importance of the vet?
Yes, sorry. So, yes, absolutely. So, as you know, there's always a vet on site at any GB-regulated track, whether the dogs are trialling or racing. The vet checks the dogs in when they first arrive. They check them before they go to race. They check them when they come back from the race. And any concerns which the vet has can be dealt with at that point. And we also then have a system in place for following through. So if a dog has incurred an injury at all, the vet will treat it, obviously, at the track. Immediate first aid is always provided. And if that then needs to be referred on, specific instructions are given and the GBGB follows up that those have been taken care of thereafter.
Thanks very much. And I'd be interested to hear from Paul why it's seen as less important, as I understand, less important to have a vet present than a bookmaker at your track.
The bookmaker, I mean, is basically fundamental to improving the experience of them racing their dog. If they want to have a small bet, and it would be a small bet. I mean, we're not talking large bets. This one bookmaker that we've got at the track, he is just there to provide that service to the people. Mm. And if they have £50 on their dog, it just makes it a little bit more exciting for them than running for a rosette. Some of the people that have run dogs at our track do also have whippets, and they'll go and race their whippets for a rosette. Mm-hmm. And there are many people at the track that will actually race, their dog don't bet it, and they'll race for nothing, just for the privilege of seeing their dog win.
But we've just heard from GBGB the importance of the role of a vet being present at a regulated track.
The GBGB have a different policy on the vet, and their organisation is a huge organisation with multi-million pound turnover. Now, if we were to employ a vet to stand at our track, he will probably charge £400. Where is that £400 going to come from? We're just a small club. We don't have the capacity to pay that. Now, you don't insist on a vet at a Whippet race meeting. You don't insist on a vet at some other amateur sports racing. So why would an amateur sport like a greyhound track have to have a vet?
Well, clearly it's an important...
I mean, if our dog hurts itself, it will get treated extremely quickly. Now, if a person hurts themselves, the doctor doesn't jump out of the bushes and come and treat them. So I find it very hard to understand why we think that a dog should have better treatment than human beings. Now, that is a bit weird. Now, I do appreciate that dog may suffer for 10 to 15 minutes in the journey to the track, to the vet. But a small child who's broken his leg playing football is going to be sitting in the car and he's got to go to accident emergency. So why is it that you think that it's so important?
I don't understand.
I mean, there are several reasons why the GBGB have a vet at their track. Now, I'm not going to... But one of the reasons is that when a trainer turns up at a GBGB track, he will have 10, maybe 13 dogs on the card. If one of his dogs was to break a leg, he can't just drop everything, take his 13 dogs, zip down to the vet. He has to have a vet at that track to treat that dog, because otherwise it would be total chaos. They wouldn't have hardly any dogs running. So, you know, there are totally different reasons why the GBGB do have a vet on the track, and they do not apply to us.
Okay, thanks for that detail. Thanks, Convener.
Well, which I forgot to say, which was also to point out that on GBGB tracks, and this is something we've introduced under this new welfare strategy, we also, in addition to what we might call the treatment vets, which is what we've just been talking about, we now have a team of so-called regional regulatory vets. So they're there really to deal with the whole regulatory side of it. Veterinary surgeons also are there on that one. Thanks for that.
So my understanding from what you've said just now is GBGB is about providing greyhounds for betting, for the gambling industry, whereas Thornton is very much about providing a facility for amateur greyhound owners to race their dogs, and the bookmaker is secondary to that desire.
But to be honest, most of the people would like the bookmaker to be there, so if they want to have £20 on their dog, they can have £20 on their dog. And we come to the conclusion that if the bookmaker isn't available, that we may just as well cancel the meeting. I mean, we have in the past, by the way, have run without the bookmaker, and people have run their dogs without the bookmaker. But on balance, we feel that if the book... I mean, bear in mind, we're not making any money out of this. And if the bookmaker says he doesn't want to go, then fundamentally we'll turn around and say, well, we won't have the meeting.
Yeah, thank you. Just further on that, Jim Fairley.
Yeah, have to admit, I've never been to a dog track in my life. No idea what it's like. But I've raced pigeons. I've been to agility tests. I've been to sheepdog trials. And I've worked with animals most of my working life. But what I'm getting from all the evidence that we've now been presented with and hearing from what I'd like to call the professional side of the business to the side that you seem to be on, Paul, is that there are two fundamentally different things happening here. The side that you're working on, and please correct me if I'm wrong, this is just my assumption, that the amateur side that you're working on is based on people who own their dogs, they're part of the family, they go to the racing, and they're part of their everyday life. So that those dogs are cared for and treated for in the same way as pets, except they'll race around the track. Whereas what we have, some of the evidence that we've taken from, is big breeders producing lots of pups, specifically with a purpose to race them to be at the highest level. If they don't hit the highest level, then they are no longer needed by the people who breed them or train them. So, correct me, am I wrong in making that assumption?
Yes, you are.
I'm wrong.
I mean, we, in most cases, or in many of the cases, when the greyhound retires, they just keep the dog as a pet for the rest of its life.
So, sorry, let me... I'm asking you, am I wrong to make the assumption that the boys that are coming to you, or the folk that are coming to yourself, that's part of the family? But
yes.
What the evidence that we've taken from with the SEWC and the yourselves from the GBGB, there's more a much more professional take to it from the point of view that the dog is a commodity rather than part of the family.
Yes.
That's the point I'm trying to get to.
Our dogs, in general, are... Probably an owner will have two, and maybe only have one. There's no big kennels, and the dog will probably have the run of the house and the garden, and is treated as a family pet. So it's totally different from the GBGB, yes.
Right, OK.
Can I just come in?
Yes, please do.
The 504 trainers that we've got licensed to us, some of them almost sit in Paul's category in so much as they're not doing it for a commercial reason. They've got dogs. We call them professional trainers because the expectations that we have of them are about the care and the welfare of their dogs, mm-hmm. and we ensure that that's there. But a good deal of those 504 are not in the category that they're doing it. They have another job. They do it because they live and they breathe greyhound racing. There are a section of those trainers also that obviously do it as a job and do it as a form of income, and that's much more on a commercial basis. And going back to the previous question, the tracks themselves, the 20 tracks, are doing it for commercial reasons. It's not just about the running of the dog and the bookmaking against it. It's also, for some people, the entertainment value of going out, taking the family, taking their friends, going having a what is now a good meal at most of the tracks and watching the dogs run. It's not all about the gambling.
Yep. Sorry, on you go.
So I was just going to say, I think that is an important point to make. I think to say, you know, the professional greyhound industry exists only to provide a gambling product is incorrect. There are other aspects of it, as Mark says, and I equally think that to kind of say on the one hand we've got this professional thing, on the other hand we've got a very family orientated thing, is also incorrect. My experience as an independent expert coming in has been very much that everyone involved in GBGB licence training is truly passionate about animal welfare, and they care very deeply for these dogs, and many of them remain involved in the lives of those dogs, whether in fact, as you said, those are dogs which never actually go racing to start with, or whether they're dogs that are homed, you know, once they finish racing they stay involved with them at that stage.
Okay, forgive me if it appeared that I was trying to demonise one side against the other. I'm not. I'm purely trying to get to an understanding of why there is an issue about dogs racing, and there clearly is, because we have people who are petitioning to get it banned. So I want to get to the point of what... Now, I know, having been worked with dogs my entire life, the care and the attention, everything else that you put into that, why would you then want to do something that's going to make that dog ill, hurt, or whatever else? Now, I've had dogs killed on the farm, working as a sheep farmer. So it happens, and I understand that these things happen. But why is there this need to stop greyhound racing when people are as passionate looking after their animals to the way that you're telling me there are? So where does it come from?
It's a really good question, because, you know, and I fulfil many roles, a lot around horse sport as well as around greyhound sport, and I completely agree. Now, this, what we're discussing today is only a very small part of human use of animals generally, and so what is different about it? And part of that may be a lack of awareness about what is actually already done for greyhound welfare. And it's important to say, always, to go to one of your points, that, you know, when a greyhound goes out to race, there is absolutely no intention ever that it should get injured. You know, that is always an accident and something everyone involved really wants to avoid, just as they want to avoid an accident to their sheepdog or to their racing pigeon or whatever.
OK, thank you.
Christine Graham.
Yes, Mr. Bignall, go back to the welfare. You said in your statement that you're only responsible for the welfare of the dogs at the track. That's correct.
We're responsible for making sure that the dog doesn't hurt itself on the track surface. Yeah. So I use my 40 years of experience in greyhound racing and working on tracks to ensure that the track is as safe as it possibly can be.
Yes, not a problem. You made it plain. It's at the track. However, you have commented on the welfare of the animals with their owners when they're not at the track and afterwards. How can you know this when you're only responsible for the welfare at the track?
I don't quite know what you're getting at. You're saying that the people come to the track, they're really nice to their dogs, they turn their dogs out in really good condition, and then they take them home, and they're not looking after them.
I'm just saying, how do you know this? You can't.
It's just common sense will tell you that if someone looks after their dog well at the track, and the dog looks in prime condition, it is not going to be abused when it goes home.
Now there's another little issue, is prime condition. You say to owners, you know, the dog's not in a fit state, they shouldn't be running them, or you won't let them run.
I said I've...
Now, there's no vet there to assess that, so can you tell me why you should be able to say, without a vet, and it might not be too obvious in certain animals, that they are not fit to be there?
What would you think would be an unfit dog?
It's not my question. I'm not an expert. You're the person who sees the dogs all the time.
If a dog is far underweight, or if a dog was injured, and it was obviously injured, and I can tell that from 40 years' experience in greyhound racing. I mean, I've had greyhounds all my life, and I can see if a dog's injured just as easily. I mean, what we need to understand here is the process of what a vet would go through to assess a dog, whether it's fit to run. He would ask you to walk your dog up and back. And he would look at the dog and he would say, is it lame? He won't give the dog a thorough examination. And, you know, the trained eye, whether it be a vet or a dog physiotherapist or a trainer, would be able to look at that dog when it's walking and would know immediately whether it was lame. Now, what you don't understand as well, anything about greyhound racing, is that all the dogs that run out of track go to physiotherapists on a regular basis. And they're all checked by physiotherapists on a regular basis. And when they come to our track, they would probably have been checked before they race anyway.
Do you know that they've been to physiotherapists?
I don't know that they've been to physiotherapists, but...
No, I'm not being difficult. You keep saying probably, and I'm just asking how far your reach is in respect to the
welfare. There's a limit to what I can do, obviously, and what you're asking me to do is impractical. We're a hobby. We're a hobby sport, and I am responsible for making sure that the track is as safe as possible. And I'm responsible to make sure the dog isn't lame when it goes onto the track. And I try my best to do that.
Yes, I accept. I understand it's the track that you're responsible for the welfare. Can I move now to GBGB? There is a difference, I would suggest, between an athlete suffering injuries, you know, an elite athlete, and a greyhound, because the athlete chooses to do it, the dog doesn't. So we just park that as a comment. Can I ask how far your responsibility, your veteran responsibility for the welfare of dogs extends? I understand from Mr. Bingle, it's the track, he may know other stuff just through passing knowledge, but for yourself, how far does it extend? For instance, does it extend towards where the dogs are bred, how they're kept, what happens to them when they're injured, what happens to them when they can no longer run? when they have euthanized, when these things happen, how far does it extend?
So there is quite a lot of detail on this provided in our written response, which we've given to you about the SORC report.
Yes.
But you're absolutely right. So as I said, we chose as a board to take responsibility for welfare across the animals' lifetime. And so in the early stages, in the pre-racing stages of greyhound's life, we work alongside, for example, the Kennel Club, and they're developing as bespoke assured breeders programme so that we can really concentrate on welfare standards around breeding. We're working alongside the Greyhound Stud Book so that we can interact with all of those who are breeding greyhounds. And because we now have in place not only the treatment vets, but also the team of regional regulatory vets, they will be helping to track and ensure the optimised welfare of dogs at that stage of their lifetime. When we go into the racing period, and of course stewards are also going in and checking on kennels, when we go into the racing period, we have an independent kennel auditor visit once a year to residential kennels. We're in the process of finalising UCAS accreditation for trainers, residential kennels. All trainers are required to be compliant with the PAS 251/2017 standard. And if there are concerns raised either by regulatory vets, by treatment vets, by the dogs, by the vets who look after the greyhounds on a day-to-day basis, or indeed by stipendiary stewards or any of the others who are visiting kennels, that can be brought back to the GB. We have a director of regulation. It can then go through the disciplinary process, which again has independent members sitting on it, and the whole system around establishing the welfare standards within kennels is run by something called the Impartiality Committee, which again has a vet on it as an independent subcommittee. And then when we go into the retired stages of a greyhound's life, at that stage, normally a greyhound would be moved into the care of a kind of non-greyhound vet, a regular vet who looks after pet animals. And so, of course, then they fall under their care and under the Animal Welfare Act are looked after as any other animal would be at that stage.
Now, am I correct in saying not all greyhounds, A, are suitable for retirement because they've not been socialised and so on? They're just, no matter what you try to do. Can I ask, you didn't answer how many dogs were being put down and for what reasons, let's take in a period of a year, last year, let's say.
OK, so I'll pass over to Mark in just a moment so he can give you some details on figures on that. In answer to your question about those dogs which are not suitable for rehoming or for homing, because it's the first time they've gone to a home, of course, that is a very small number, and we are nonetheless very committed to driving that down. So within the welfare strategy, we have a particular stream around behaviour. We're working with one of the charities specifically within the Greyhound Forum around this, and there are several strands to that work, which include, importantly, as you mentioned, making sure that in the early stages of a greyhound's life, everyone responsible for it, make sure that it is socialised at that stage in a way in which will make it easy to go to a domestic home at the point at which it retires. So that's one programme we're developing in collaboration with a charity, a canine charity, a standardised process of assessment of behaviour of greyhounds, and we're making sure that we have in place, again, along with the charity, a number of behaviourists to whom greyhounds can be referred. So we're very conscious of that, and we have systems in place for it, but I'll pass over to Mark for the detail.
Yes, please.
I think, Christine, when we met, which is about 4 years ago when you were heading out across party...
Yes, I've got more recent correspondence, but I can't see it because the committee has not seen it.
No, but I think that we had only just started collating track injury figures, and within that there were fatal figures as well, but also in terms of what happened to dogs at the end of their racing careers, and i.e. going into retirement. So I think when we first started collating the numbers back in 2018, there were 242 dogs died at the track back in 2018. So they were put to sleep or caused sudden death at the track, and obviously overseen by a vet. That was in 2018. Last or 2021 figures, which are the most relevant figures we've got, has seen that number decrease to 120. So it's a 50% reduction in terms of 4 years on where we were on track fatalities for greyhounds. In terms of injuries, that's pretty much remained the same in terms of where we are in terms of numbers of runs versus number of dogs that are running. I can give you other figures on other fatalities if you want as well.
Well, yes, because that's died at track, either put down at the track or otherwise. But what about dogs not suitable for retirement?
Well, it depends on what you're saying they're unsuitable for. If you're saying they're unsuitable for homing, which says that tends to...
Or homing, do you put down dogs that are not injured?
So dogs that are unsuitable for homing. So there's some behavioural problem with the dog. Again, back in 2018... there are 190 that were put to sleep because of that particular reason by vets.
Is that out of the 242 or additional?
No, this is additional.
Right.
So it's 190.
But now,
2021's figures, that had reduced to just 13. a reduction of 93%.
Okay.
And the reason that came about was because we worked with trainers around the culture of, you mentioned earlier about them being a commodity, and trying to get them away from the fact that a dog is not a commodity, that it's a sentient being, and it's been used in racing, and therefore went on to retirement. So the work that we've done over the 4 years has seen that number drop by 93%.
Yeah. So the absolute number is very, very small, but we are not complacent about that. And no. You know, that's exactly why we've got this huge collaborative programme within the welfare strategy to do everything we can to make it easier for greyhounds to transition to a domestic life when they retire.
That was helpful. I'll stop there if I might come back later.
Thank you. It was remiss of me not to mention that we've got Matt Ruskell, MSP, with us, who's taken an interest in this topic very closely, as we have taken evidence, and Mark will have opportunity to ask some questions. I'm going to bring in Ariane Burgess and then Matt Ruskell.
Thanks very much, Convener. I just wanted to go back to pick up a little bit of a thread connected to Christine Graham's questions, and it's around the the independent track owner. Be interested to hear about. So, in your written evidence, Thornton Greyhound Stadium wrote that obviously, if they felt that an owner was failing in their duty to look after their dog properly, then they would address that. And I'd be interested to hear, picking up on the conversation earlier about the vet, in the situation that a greyhound is injured, what's the next steps that you take, given that there is no vet present on the site and only out-of-office emergency vet services are available on a Saturday night when races at the track take place?
We have a vet who is at home on Saturday nights, and we would ring him immediately and the dog would go to his surgery to be treated.
Okay, thanks for that clarification.
Matt Ruskell.
Convener, I want to go back to the issue of euthanasia, and you introduced some figures there. I gather that there are 1,400 dogs that were euthanised over a four-year period from 2018 to 21 for a range of different reasons, including difficulties rehoming, but also treatment costs and other issues. But I wanted to ask yourself, Dr. Campbell, about some comments that I think you made recently in relation to euthanasia. You said, I think these are your words, euthanasia at the end of a racing career has the advantage that the fate of the animal is secured, and the guarantee that the animal will not suffer any subsequent welfare problems. Can you explain what you meant by that? Because on the face of it, it sounds like you're saying that they'd be better off dead.
Yeah, no, of course I'm not saying that. And as always, you know, when things are taken out of context, they need to be explained. So you're absolutely right. I think euthanasia, by definition, is a humane process. So we need to be very clear that by definition, euthanasia is not a welfare issue, and what we're very concerned about, of course, always is improving welfare standards. So that's exactly why we're undertaking all the work we're talking about you know, driving down, constantly striving to drive down, you know, injuries which result in a genuine need to euthanize the dog because they can't be treated, or to do everything we can to give the dog the best possible chance of having a set of behaviours which allow it to be successfully homed at the end of its racing career. So I'm not for a moment, of course, suggesting you know, that greyhounds would be better off being euthanized. Absolutely not. That's been taken out of context. Well, and it's exactly as I've just
said. It's difficult
described.
To explain the words that you have there. I mean, you're saying that it's a humane process, euthanasia.
By definition.
Surely euthanasia is a humane process if it's in response to something which is unavoidable, whereas an injury which is sustained by a greyhound going around a track at 40 mile an hour is avoidable. So how is that a humane process that dogs are being euthanized?
Okay,
in that
so
context?
I think you're confounding two things here, if I might say so. So as I've said, from a scientific view, by definition, okay, euthanasia is humane. That is the definition of euthanasia. But what you're talking about is whether it is ethically reasonable for dogs to run if the possible consequence is that they will become injured. And then you talk about avoidable risk. So, of course, this is exactly the same across all animal sports, of course, equine sports, other dog sports, as well as greyhound sports. And we do have to accept that all animal sports, as all human sports, have some risk of injury associated with them. But what we are constantly trying to do is to identify the risk, which exactly as you say, is avoidable. And that's why we have all of this increase in granularity around the data, why we have all of the research written into the strategy, so that we can understand very well the causes of injuries and we can understand what we can do to mitigate them. And then we have an absolute responsibility to do everything we can to mitigate the causes of those injuries, so that what we are left then is only the unavoidable risk. So it's not an avoidable risk, as long as we are constantly trying to undertake that research and to improve practice and policy.
I'll maybe come back later, convener.
Thank you. I'm really struggling here. We're not comparing apples with apples. And most of the information we've had from Scottish Animal Welfare was around the activities of GBGB and professional, industrial scale greyhound racing, if you like to put it that way. But one of the things we haven't had, and which makes it difficult, is a lack of information surrounding the one and only flapper track, as they described, the unlicensed tracks. You know, there is legislation in place specifically to protect greyhounds. Greyhounds are mentioned in the legislation. But what confidence can we have that there isn't animal welfare issues at Thornton if they're not regularly inspected somehow? It's my understanding that the SSPCA don't have access or haven't taken access to Thornton, and we don't have any other way for understanding actually whether there are or are not animal welfare issues at the track and subsequently in the breeding of those animals. And from what you're saying, you know, most of it's a hobby thing. So how are we to understand how we can improve animal welfare if we actually don't know Scotland specific, because we have no GBGB tracks in Scotland. We've only got an unlicensed track. So how can we have confidence, or what needs to be put in place that we know that the current legislation is ensuring the best welfare for greyhounds? Is there more that you think SSPCA should be doing or the government should be doing to ensure animal welfare at these tracks? Because all the information in front of us is around GBGB, and from what I understand, it's comparing apples with pears. Your business at Thornton is completely different from the GBGB model.
We would be more than welcoming to the SSPCA if they wanted to come. And in fact, we have written to Mike Flynn saying, you know, you've had every opportunity to come and visit our track. And he did eventually come with Professor Dwyer to the track. I don't think that he was in any way concerned about anything that went on up the track. And the same thing would happen if he'd have come at any time. And as I say, the invitation has been open to him, and he's more than welcome to come if he wants to.
OK. Jim Fairley.
That's OK. Right, OK, well, I'm going to come back to the point about euthanasia. I presume that when you get to a point where a dog is going to be euthanised, when you say it's unsuitable for rehoming, it's either because of a severe injury or the dog's temperament or whatever. How did you manage to reduce it from the 180-odd that you had to 19? And what were the differences? Why did people change their mind about euthanasia?
OK, so first of all, we should talk about homing rather than rehoming, because they haven't been homed until they go to that stage of their lives. It's a really interesting question, you know, and there is a lot around decision making, and so there is the scientific part around which injuries can be successfully treated. There are questions around how quickly we can refer to specialist centres, and we have a big work stream within the strategy on making sure we can do that really effectively. And there are questions around making sure that everyone understands very clearly the responsibility for doing everything we possibly can to successfully treat injured greyhounds. So I can hand over to Mark, and he can talk a little bit about the injury treatment schemes.
Well, we have the injury recovery scheme, which obviously limits when a dog is injured and it goes into treatment with a vet that's at the track. Obviously, it's pretty emotional because the dog is probably in pain, and it's a question of actually changing that culture from when the dog was in pain, you've got the owner there or the trainer or one of the kennel hands who's obviously upset themselves because the dog had become injured, it sometimes led to the dog being unnecessarily being put to sleep because that's what people were thinking was the best course of action. When actually it wasn't, it was actually more a case of we haven't really got a prognosis on what the injury is here, and working with the vet to give that dog some immediate pain relief, you could then actually make an assessment as to whether or not, you know, what the injury, the scale of the injury was, and what the forward-thinking prognosis was going to be. So that's caused some of the changes. Going back to unsuitable for homing, it isn't because the dog, it is just about behaviour. This was an assessment that the owner or the trainer would say that a dog wouldn't home, and as a result of which was then put to sleep. And that was happening far too often, and in our view, that was unacceptable and unnecessary. So we've worked very hard with trainers and owners to work on what the behavioural problems are with most of these dogs. And you've seen the numbers yourself. They've changed radically. And that's by a process of changing the culture.
But there's also funding available to help with treatment costs.
Well, there's treatment cost funding. There's also funding in relation to getting dogs retired as well. So when a dog enters racing, it receives a retirement bond, which is paid for by the owner, which is £200. When the dog then comes to retire, that £200 is then released for the dog with a further £200 from the Greyhound Board as well to assist with the homing journey of that particular greyhound. The injury recovery scheme, again, helps fund some of the treatment costs of those dogs when they are injured. And if you're talking about a long bone injury, you could be talking anything up to about £5,000, which, again, if you've got dogs as pets, you realise that some people with domestic pets cannot afford to do that. We take the responsibility, as do the owners in our sport, that actually, if a dog is savable as a result of an injury, then we should be doing our utmost to make sure that dog is looked after as best as possible, and that includes the treatment.
OK, can I follow on that thing? Yeah. If your dogs have got these bonds and what have you, and I'm interested to say that you're not rehoming because they've never been home, that goes back to the point that I was trying to get to earlier on, where dogs are bred for a specific purpose to race only, whereas my understanding, and again I could be wrong, is that when you're at the amateur track, dogs are very much part of the family. And please don't think I'm trying to make that differentiation between the two things. So at a professional track, do your owners have insurance? Because if I'm a pet owner, my dog gets injured, I can have pet insurance that will then allow that dog to get treated up to a certain amount. Do you have insurance? And Paul, do your guys who are racing people, sorry, I should correct myself, the folk who come to your racing track, do they insure their dogs against injury on the basis that there is a risk to the dogs getting hurt if they're going around the track?
No, you would be very lucky if you could find a pet insurance policy that would insure a greyhound that was racing. Mm-hmm. So no, they're not insured. It's fully the responsibility of the owner to make sure that his dog's well looked after if he does get injured.
And it's the same on the professional side.
To put things into perspective, we had throughout the whole of last year, we did have two bad injuries, which needed treatment promptly by a vet. One of them was a broken leg, which was fixed, and the dog is now sitting on the guy's sofa. And the other one broke its wrist, and unfortunately the owner decided that the cost to have it fixed was too high, and he had it put to sleep. Something we don't encourage, but it is fundamentally their choice.
Okay. That kind of goes back to the point that the convener made earlier on. We don't know how many dogs will get euthanised from the folk who come and race at your track, but we've got statistics. So we can make that argument and that judgment. It goes back to the question that came in and asked, how do we have confidence as a committee that how your track is being run will allow this committee and the wider public to have confidence that what you guys are doing will meet the standards and the requirement of people's expectations of animal welfare?
Well, we provided the committee and the SAWC with all our race videos. And believe me, if a dog breaks its leg, it is blatantly obvious. Anyone can see it. So if you looked at the videos, you could see that there was no other serious injuries throughout the course of the year's racing. Now, I'm not saying that there wouldn't have been some muscle injuries. And as previously, all athletes
and all animals that take part in any competition will pick up muscle injuries. I mean, whether it's even flyball, you know, you might think that's a totally harmless sport, but the wrists take an absolute pounding in flyball, and a lot of the dogs get serious wrist injuries. It's just the nature of taking part in a competition, whether it be an animal or a human, there is an element of risk, and you're going to pick up injuries.
Okay.
But all these injuries will be treated, and all these dogs will make a recovery, and if they don't recover, they will be homed by probably by the person that owns them in the first place. And on the odd occasion, they might get sent to a rehoming centre to be rehomed.
Mark, did you yourself or Marlon want to come in on that?
Well, just to cover off the point again about that, even in professional greyhound racing, there is very little chance that you can get insurance to cover a dog, as I'm sure it's exactly the same with horse racing. Well, the IRS, the injury recovery scheme we spoke about, is almost a form of insurance which allows a dog to be treated, or the costs, some of the costs met. And the point Malin was going to make was the fact that some of the tracks as well will meet any additional cost over and above what we put in under the injury recovery scheme. So if it's a long bone injury and it's £5,000, the owner's not going to have to pay out anything on that for that dog to be treated. And some of us have an issue about it, because it's again about a responsible ownership. But that responsible ownership comes at the very end when that dog is due to retire and the owner doing the right thing by that dog.
OK, thank you.
But ownership as a GBGB licensed owner is completely different from the owners that would be racing at Thornton. So they're owners in terms of they own an asset rather than they own a lap dog, if you like.
I think the quandary is very obvious with the committee today. As you said, apples and pears between the two. You know, we instill upon all of our owners that come to bring dogs to licensed sport that there is that ownership responsibility there, and we make sure that through our rules that's adhered to. In Paul's case, he's working on the basis that these are family pets and they're used to race, and the ownership and the responsibility follows through on that, I think.
Yes.
Yeah.
Everything Mark's just said is true, but I don't think it's really probably fair to owners of greyhounds who are racing under GBGB licence to describe them, their animals as being an asset to them. You know, these owners are very attached to their animals often, and of course, like all owners, ultimately under the Animal Welfare Acts in both nations, have ultimate responsibility for the welfare of their greyhounds.
But the majority of the greyhounds are kennelled at a GBGB location rather than being kennelled at the owner's home.
They have to be kennelled, and the reason being, a few years back again, when I came to speak to Christine, we did have dogs, especially in Scotland, that were being housed in the home. The problem we have with that is there's access then to all manner of different substances that a dog could get their nose into, including things like tea, coffee, chocolate, that actually at a licensed track they could be tested for, and they're all prohibited. So we had to actually do away with that type of licence, and the only type of licence now ensures that a dog is kept in kennels for their racing career.
So this, we are absolutely not comparing apples with apples. That just reinforces
in many ways, other than as Madeline and Paul have said about the owner's responsibility for their dogs.
Yeah. We are and we aren't. I mean, the systems are different, you're quite right, but what's important, of course, from the animal's point of view, and this is very much how we look at things nowadays in animal welfare, is the animal's lived experience of its own welfare. So what's important, and in fact this goes to Mr. Ruskell's question about the kind of the quality of an animal's life and whether it's a life worth living, which is a baseline level, or whether it's a good life, and that's exactly what we're describing within this strategy. You know, what's important, whichever system they're in, is that their welfare needs are being met, and those are clearly described in legislation, and they're also very clearly described within this five domains model, which we've adopted within the welfare strategy, and the way in which we will meet each and do and will meet each of them is also described within the welfare strategy.
Okay. I've got three supplementaries from Christine, Karen and Mark before we move on to the next topic. Just, again, I'm at fault here as well, but just remind everybody the time constraints we've got. Christine.
To be short. The first is just to Mr. Bignall. Has there been an increase in usage at your track since the closure of all the licensed tracks in Scotland?
No.
Thank you. And to Mr. Bird, when you've got data, which we've not gone into all the details for time, What is there a form that is completed at the track or subsequently to detail why an animal was put down?
Correct, yes.
Have we seen a copy of that form?
Well, the form has actually only just recently been revised, but again, we can provide you with a copy.
Could we see a copy of that form, please, if that's appropriate? And could I see the previous form to see the amendments that have been made?
Well, will it explain why those amendments have been made as well?
Thank you.
Thank you. Karen.
I would just like to ask, in regards to behaviour issues, that's been mentioned a few times, can we get some clarity on that, just for the record? What kind of behaviour issues are we talking about, and perhaps why that's happened?
So a lot of it is related to greyhounds finding it stressful to be in a domestic environment because it's not what they've been used to in up until that stage of their life. And so that's exactly why we're putting these systems in place, as I say, in collaboration with the charities, but one charity in particular within the Greyhound Forum, to help everyone who looks after a greyhound from the moment at which it's born, you know, in its pre-racing stage, and then when it goes racing, to accustomize them to things. For example, I mean, it sounds really silly, like hoovers or sofas or, you know, noise generally, and just kind of general household objects, so that then when they come to retire, that is not a stressful environment for them that they're entering.
So that, how does that behaviour manifest? Sorry, I know there'd be stress, that's the emotion, but how...
It depends, it's very variable dog to dog. So, I mean, sometimes, you know, a stressed dog will kind of very much withdraw into itself, and sometimes it may, this is rare in greyhounds, but sometimes could become overtly aggressive again, just simply because it's stressed. And so the fundamental thing is to reduce the causes of the stress through appropriate management in order that they don't exhibit any of those behaviours later on.
An actual example of that is I've got a retired greyhound at home, and when we got him from the trainer, we were told, because we have two other dogs which are non-greyhounds, don't feed that particular ex-racer with those two dogs, because he's always been used to eating on his own. And so we did that for a number of days or weeks, but then one day, obviously, human error, we looked away and then found my other dog had her nose in the same bowl as the greyhound. Nothing. So someone's perceptional as well, because they've been handled in a particular way as a working dog, as a canine athlete, people have this perception that they're going to react in a different way, and sometimes they do and sometimes they don't.
OK, thanks.
Roscoe.
Can I ask about the GBGB data on retirement? Because as I understand it, it also includes greyhounds that are designated for breeding and also greyhounds that go on to race unregulated tracks. So can you explain how that constitutes retirement?
So it's retirement from the sport.
Retirement from GBGB.
From regulated sport, yes.
Right, OK.
But obviously under the new welfare
strategy.
They
might then move on to unregulated sport somewhere else.
Well, not anymore.
No longer.
Okay.
Because that loophole has been closed.
Have you ever had greyhounds that have had a racing career at GBGB regulated tracks, at your track?
To say we've never had one would not be true.
What's your data on that?
It's rare, to be honest.
But Mr. Russell, you're taking
a historical perspective, because in the welfare strategy, which was published almost a year ago now, it is explicitly stated that we, the GBGB, don't any longer find that an acceptable outcome at the point of retirement of a dog from regulated racing to be going to unregulated racing. We are completely clear about that.
Okay, but how do you actually monitor that? Because Mr. Brignall is now saying that you think it's rare, but do you have data on where the dogs are coming from?
Historically, it probably has happened, but we haven't got any at the moment that there are ex-GBGB racers.
Okay, so you don't have data on how many ex-GBGB racers have raced in the past at Thornton and how many are racing now? It's just a perception that...
Well, all the dogs that run at our track at the moment have been with the owners that they've got now for a long time, and they haven't raced on GBGB tracks.
OK. So would GBGB be concerned if racers that were at your formerly licensed tracks were racing at Thornton, because clearly that would be in breach of your new welfare standards. And how would you monitor that?
So when a dog comes up for retirement from licensed racing, the owner has to fill out a green form, a retirement form, and clearly on there it talks about who the new owner is going to be. In the event that we and we have an investigations officer, find out that a dog has perhaps not gone to the person that sent it onto the form, or conversely has gone into unlicensed racing, then that would be followed up. And then the owner may or may not be able to then have any more registered dogs with the GBGB. Okay. So there is a method of being able to...
So how many cases such as that have been brought forward?
Well, to date, no.
Because we introduced that a year ago when we published the welfare strategy.
Okay.
And, yeah, we're not aware of
any. There's been no cases brought forward. OK.
Thank you. Karen Adam.
Thank you. Convener, I'd like to ask, we've spoken a lot about the regulations in themselves. Can you tell me a bit more about the differences between the regulations in Scotland and England and what kind of impacts and any effects that's had on animal welfare?
Under the Welfare of Racing Greyhounds regulations, there's lots of things that we've been talking about all the way through this committee meeting, so things like the presence of a vet being there, in terms of residential kennels, etc. So there's an awful lot of what we've literally been speaking to fall under those regulations, which aren't currently being applied within Scotland or Wales, for that matter. So, you know, our basis has always been, the reason for being here, as you quite rightly said, there are no GBGB licensed tracks in Scotland anymore. But our view on this is that actually, rather than going for a ban or a phased ending of greyhound racing, that perhaps regulation could be adopted by Scotland as well. And that could include, obviously, the similar or same regulations that are in England at the moment. The problem you have is, as Paul says, as a hobbyist track, that would be the death knell for them.
OK.
Beatrice Wishart.
Thanks, Convener. I think my question follows on from Karen's question. So just kind of get your views and on the report, the SAWC report and findings that recommends that the scheme independent of GBGB is required to ensure the welfare of greyhounds and, quote, possibly through local authority regulation or under the auspices of the new Scottish Veterinary Service. I wonder if I could have your views on that.
I would think, you're talking to me, I would imagine that the SSPCA would be the ideal people to monitor our track. And we have invited them to do so. They have chosen not to because maybe their workload is already too big, but that's their choice.
But you wouldn't have any problem with any kind of regulations?
Sorry?
You wouldn't have any problem with regulations as suggested by the...
We wouldn't mind the SSPCA regularly checking our track. That would not be a problem for us in any way, shape or form.
We don't agree with the view that there is a requirement for additional independent regulation of GBGB licensed racing. The board of GBGB already has four independent directors, of whom I'm one. The chair was previously chief executive of the RSPCA and a director at the Dogs Trust. Among the other independent directors, we have one who served as a shadow environment minister and a senior member of EFRACOM, so obviously has a very strong background in animal welfare. And we have one who's a partner in a solicitor's firm with decades of experience in regulation around sport. So we already have quite a lot of independent oversight. We already also have a Greyhound Regulatory Board, which is independent of the GBGB, that manages the rules of racing and everything that goes around that. We have an independent disciplinary committee with members including lawyers, a veterinary surgeon, experienced sports stakeholders. We also have, under the UCAS accreditation requirements, an impartiality committee. And again, that includes a lawyer and a veterinary surgeon and a Greyhound Forum, a charity member, and a senior animal licensing officer. So we do believe that there is already a very high degree of independent oversight.
Thank you.
Once again, it's difficult because there's no GBGB tracks in Scotland, so we are effectively scrutinising what happens in an area which we can't get involved in, but I think it's important we understand how you're regulated. Can you make it clear the GBGB is not a statutory body, it's a body which its members are generally made up from those who are participating or have an interest in the sport, and that goes the same for the regulatory board. It's not appointed by government, it's not appointed through legislation. You're a self-governing body. Is that correct?
Through that, we're self-regulated. But of course, we do report to DEFRA and we report to DCMS as well. So there is even governmental oversight in terms of what we do.
And to the canine charities through the Greyhound Forum, you know, and we interact with them regularly, and we have undertaken, and it's written within the strategy that we report upon progress to them about that regularly.
OK, thank you. Christine Graham.
I've run out of questions. I don't think it's me, because I've done mine.
OK, that's fine, Rachel.
Except perhaps if you could see the form that's filled in on retirement, could I ask the forms about animals that are put down?
It's the same form.
It's the same form.
Yes.
That's it. So that's really all.
OK.
Clarification. Thank you. Sorry, Rachel.
It's OK. Can I ask Mr Bird why in the letter, in response to the SAWC report, why you didn't think that their report was objective and that there were some inaccuracies within that report?
I'll defer to Madeline.
Well, Professor Campbell.
Your letter came from you, but it's the letter which Mark and our chair submitted is very detailed, and I think probably goes a long way to answering that. A lot of what was in there, as you will have seen in that response, we felt was based on outdated information and some factual inaccuracies.
OK. I think we're going to go on to the parts about the breeding and in later questions, so I'll leave a supplementary to that.
OK. Can I ask, the committee have noted that 91.7% of respondents to the committee's call for views said that they supported a ban on greyhound racing in Scotland, and I take on board the comments you've made regarding those who completed the feedback, but I wonder if you could give us an indication, both parties, on what the impact of a ban would be, an outright ban, or potentially a phasing out of greyhound racing in Scotland. What effect would that have, including any cross-border implications of that ban? I'll maybe start with Mark and then move to Paul.
So, obviously, we had a licence track. We mustn't forget that. That was in Glasgow, which is Shawfield. That was a casualty of COVID, because they weren't, as like most other tracks, on a media deal, i.e. the racing wasn't being shown in bookmaker shops, so they did rely on footfall. And sadly, because of COVID and the restrictions, which obviously carried on in Scotland as well, that closed its doors and never reopened as a result of COVID. That's now left us currently with 23 Scottish-based trainers, or Scotland-based trainers, that are now travelling between wherever their bases are in Scotland to most likely Newcastle or Sunderland or even to Peel or Grange. So, the effect of a ban, it depends on the detail, but it may well be that even Scotland-based trainers couldn't actually carry out what they're doing, assuming they're doing it for payment to come over to the border to England. Our views has always been the same, and it's obviously you're aware of what's happening in the Senate as well with Wales with regards to a petition for a ban, is that actually both the governments, have they done enough to actually look at the legislation and the regulation without having to go for a ban? Because actually to ban something outright, from our point of view, we'll just drive it underground.
But I suppose we've got an example of the effects that might, how that might play out, because we've got in practice your licence track did stop. What happened to the dogs that you were licensing to race in Glasgow? What was the immediate impact of that?
Well, it goes back to, again, most of the dogs that were at Shawfield were very much owners, were the trainers, and the trainers had probably two or three dogs. There were very few big owners that were racing at the track. It only raced one night a week. It was, as I said, it wasn't on a media deal, so there was no real incentive for trainers to have much in the way of dogs. So actually, some of the trainers that do it as a professional living, as I said, they've transferred over. Other trainers have just retired their dogs and are no longer racing.
OK. Paul, what would the impact of an outright ban or a phase ban be on your track?
Well, I think the injustices of banning greyhound racing would be terrible. I don't actually understand why you would want to ban greyhound racing. That's the first thing. I don't think that anyone has ever come forward with a good enough reason to ban greyhound racing in compared with other sports. But obviously, if it was banned, then we would just have to close.
Okay. Alistair.
Thank you, Convener. Ultimately, here, we're not talking about government proposals, we're talking about a petition, and so today is your chance to respond to that. So I preface my question by pointing that out, because this is not an accusation from me, but the petitioners, however, have made an accusation, and that accusation is that they raised concerns about drug use amongst with dogs, and specifically cocaine. My understanding is that the Scottish Animal Welfare Commission have not made that accusation, but the petitioners have. So I wonder if you can respond to that, please.
So the instances of cake or any Class A use in terms of doping for dogs, and obviously cocaine is something that would be used in a dog with a view to trying to get it to run faster. There are other prohibited articles out there that would make a dog run slower. But of course, with the testing regime that goes on, certainly within GBGB licensed tracks, any Class A drug that would be used in that type of event would show up. Dogs can either be randomly sampled in races, or if there is intelligence to say there's something going on, then again that could be targeted. But the actual percentages of those that actually come through are minuscule. They're less than 1%. So of all the races, and last year there were 359,000 runs, sorry, there was less than 1% of those that came back as a positive, and even fewer, lesser percentage on that in terms of Class A. This is one of the problems that we had when we had dogs staying within doors, especially within London. If you look at some of the Shawfield positives that we have, it was for Class A drug or for things like beta blockers, which obviously are used for people with heart complaints. But again, we're talking minuscule numbers, because the deterrent is there, because the dogs could be tested.
And Mr. Brignall, do you have any comment on that with regard to your own track?
Well, there's no requirement to test for us, and I don't really see any reason why anyone would want to cheat and use drugs to test. Would you want to use drugs at our track? I mean, what are they going to win? 50 quid, 100 quid? It's not the same situation. I mean, if you go onto the GBGB track and you race a dog, if you were inclined to cheat, then, or wanted to try and cheat, well, I don't think they'd get away with it, to be honest with you, but if they wanted to try and cheat, the potential is there for them to bet with hundreds of bookmaking companies, and they could put thousands of pounds on. That's not an issue with us in any way, shape or form.
So testing doesn't...
We don't test, no. And as Mark said, to be honest, if you found cocaine in a dog from a GBGB test, more than likely it's because the owner is taking cocaine and he stroked the dog. Because the test is so sensitive that it will find the minutest traces. I mean, even poppy seeds in bread, a dog will fail because it will have opium in the poppy seeds in the bread. So if you feed the dog poppy seed bread, it's likely to fail a GBGB test.
But, and to pick up on Mr. Brignall's point, I mean, that is exactly the advantage, of course, of not having dogs during the racing period of their lives living within a domestic environment, which is the way we do it in GBGB.
Okay, thank you.
Just follow up on that. So there may well be, whether it happens or not, there may be an incentive because of the return on betting to enhance the performance illegally of a greyhound through a GBGB track. However, at Thornton, are you saying that the only bookkeeping service available is the one bookkeeper on track, so there is no external or online betting on that? Okay, thank you. I'm now going to move to a question from Rachel Hamilton.
Yep. Thank you. It was just to pick up, it was one of the points that GBGB had made in the SAWC report, particularly their emphasis on their concern about the welfare standards for breeding and the importation of dogs from Ireland. I just wondered, from the response that you gave, if you could let the committee know with regards to what you're doing in terms of developing some sort of harmonised set of standard welfare standards for breeding.
Yes.
Thank you. So, and you're exactly right. It's a question which kind of spans GB, GB and Ireland. So you will have seen in our welfare strategy that, as I mentioned earlier, we're working with the Kennel Club, who are developing a bespoke assured breeders scheme for greyhounds, and that is currently in development and will be shortly piloted. And that will then form the basis for us collaborating with Irish counterparts in making sure that standards are raised internationally. And in fact, that's also part of a wider piece of work. So in March this year, GBGB hosted a meeting of international regulators specifically focused on welfare, and that is the first of what will be a series of meetings, and the Irish attended that along with all of the other main international regulators. And the purpose of those meetings is exactly so that we can share best practice, so that we can align standards, and we now have an online platform on which to do that. Members of GBGB, a small number of us, will be going out later this spring to Ireland specifically to talk to our counterparts about breeding welfare and to make a visit there to understand better how we can all work together, again, to make sure that standards are raised uniformly internationally. Having said all of that, part of what's within our welfare strategy is also that we very much want to drive British breeding of racing greyhounds, because once it's in GBGB, we absolutely have oversight of it, and we don't so much when it's in Ireland. And also that means dogs wouldn't be being transported, and you know, we would rather, from a welfare point of view, they were bred and stayed in the same country. And so we have various pieces of work in place to support that. And you will have seen that, in fact, the number of British bred racing greyhounds has increased substantially over the last few years. And indeed, by chance, this year, the Derby was won by a British bred greyhound.
There seemed to be an emphasis on the Scottish Animal Welfare Commission report on that aspect of welfare. Mm-hmm. But I just wondered how, in terms of the context of this petition, if I made the point to Cathy Dwyer in the committee session in March, that surely that there are currently regulations and animal welfare standards that can deal with that aspect of animal welfare and, yeah, you know, importing young animals. You know, the number of puppies that one animal is having, etc., etc. I wonder if you can comment on that, because it was part of the report that actually concerned me.
So you're absolutely right. Of course, I mean, you know, everything greyhounds do kind of falls under general national canine legislation, and part of that, as you quite rightly say, relates to transportation, and part of that relates to breeding. So we have the breeding of dogs regulations, but who falls under that is dependent, amongst other things, upon the number of litters the bitches are having per year, for example. And so what we're working to do, and this is what we're collaborating with the Greyhound Stud Book on, and also with some of the charities within the Greyhound Forum, because this is one of the things that they flagged up when I first started developing the strategy, was that we're working to understand very clearly which greyhound breeders within GB fall under which regulations, and then to ensure through our role as regulator that each of them understands very clearly what their responsibilities are under that legislation and that they are compliant with them.
Okay. And can I ask also, just because obviously it was because it was such a large part of your response to the report itself, going back to my original question about the report being objective, have you seen the, I can't find the reference to it now, but have you seen the RSPCA
Dogs
Trust and Blue Cross report?
No.
Why has that not been published?
We went to, both Madeline, myself and our chair, went to the RSPCA, or Dogs Trust offices, getting over 2 years ago, where they said that they wanted to review their position in relation to all greyhound racing, not just GBGB related racing, but also the independent. And their reason for doing it was because they didn't think that we were acting sufficiently quick enough, or that we had the money in which to do what we wanted to do. We had already got Madeline embarked on doing the welfare strategy that was published in last May. They even asked us to stall that strategy work whilst they carried out their own review, which we we contributed to 100% along with some of the other animal welfare charities as well. We published, as I said, our welfare strategy in May. They published theirs, well, actually, they declared what the results of their report was in September of last year, but they've not shared that report with us or any of the animal welfare charities, or even alluded to why their position has changed. They've just said that greyhound racing in their book now was cruel and abhorrent, and that's why they were going to call for a phase ban to greyhound racing. Again, so we're not only seeing the report, it was over a five-year period that they asked for the ban to take place. So they are heading towards their first year of declaring that to be their position, and yet we're still seeing no evidence whatsoever, A, from their report, but also how they see a phased ban coming about.
It is a matter of frustration to me that we haven't seen that report, despite having repeatedly asked to have sight of it, and indeed the Greyhound Forum itself has asked to be provided with a copy of it and hasn't been. And the reason that's particularly a matter of frustration to me is, you know, we are all in this together. We, all of us, want to optimise greyhound welfare. And when I set out to develop the strategy, I asked each of the charities who sits within the Greyhound Forum, and I sent them a form to fill in and send back to let us know what they thought current welfare issues were and what they thought potential welfare issues might be. And they all did that. And I considered all of those, and all of it was incorporated within the welfare strategy. So if they are now saying, you know, there's something we're still missing, I want to know what it is so that we can do something about it. And yet, yeah, they won't let us see their report.
Can I ask the committee if it's a report that you've seen?
There is a summary as part of the SAWC report, yeah, but the actual full report has not been published or given to us.
Okay, thanks. Mark.
Yeah, thanks, convener. I wanted to sort of go back to the nub of the argument, really, which I think the petitioners are raising, and also the evidence that Scottish Animal Welfare Commission reflected on veterinary evidence. And that's the nature of a dog racing at 40 mile an hour around an oval track. Now, as I understand it, GBGB is doing research into track design. This might seem like a bit of a daft question, but are you doing research into straight tracks rather than oval tracks?
So we are working as part of the international collaboration with other regulators, which I just described, to really look in detail at the evidence base, because there's already some work being done in other countries. And then, as you will have seen in the letter which we sent back to this committee, GBGB will ask Dr. Richard Payne, who's at Nottingham University, to have oversight of all of that and make recommendations to us on what there needs to be further research on, which might inform future policy developments around this. So, but there are repeated mentions in, yeah, in the strategy
so
about
track
design.
Is that a
design.
Yes on straight track?
We're looking at the evidence from all countries.
All of the veterinary evidence shows that it's the turn, that first curve of the turn, the speed which the dogs are going, the impact that has on legs.
Well, when you say all veterinary evidence, that's a report that was done by Andrew Wykes.
Well, so to go back to my question, are you looking at straight tracks?
Well, as Madeline said, we're looking at all the options.
Are you looking at straight tracks?
Including straight tracks.
Okay.
Yes, at the evidence and then from other countries.
Another question then, just for Paul. I mean, there's been a bit of discussion this morning about apples and pears and the difference between regulated and unregulated tracks. Is your track design the same as a GB track? Is it fundamentally different in terms of shape?
Similar. The only difference is it's got an inside hair.
Right.
Most of the other tracks are outside here.
Right.
Most of the GB, well, all the GB tracks are outside here.
But it's not fundamentally different.
No.
To Shorefield, for example, or any
It's
other track.
Slightly smaller than Shorefield.
Right.
It's probably a very similar size to Sunderland. Is quite.
Okay. So on that basis, then, would you say that the inherent risk that a dog faces by running at 40 mile an hour around an oval-shaped track in Thornton is the same as a dog running an oval-shaped track in London or Glasgow or anywhere else?
I don't honestly think that you're right in
right.
Well, the
why am I wrong then?
I mean, although there are reports that say that an oval-shaped track is slightly dangerous,
there's no evidence to show that if it was a straight track and the dog was pulling up at the end, he still wouldn't injure himself.
There's substantial veterinary evidence which the Scottish Animal Welfare Commission has reflected on, and clearly GBGB will be looking at that evidence as well with their own review. So come back to the question, where is your evidence that what you have in Thornton with an oval-shaped track with dogs running around at 40 mile an hour is different to an oval-shaped track at Shorefield with dogs running around at 40 mile an hour? How are the inherent risks of a more of a hobby sport any different to that of a professional track?
Obviously, they're not. The only thing I would say is that because we don't race quite so often, the track doesn't get compacted quite as often as a GBGB track will get compacted.
Okay.
But apart from that, I would say it's very similar.
Okay. All right. Thanks.
Thank you. Just finally, throughout the evidence, there's been a suggestion or it's been implied that unlicensed or flapper tracks are more dangerous, more likely to have potentially illegal activity or whatever. Do you think that's the case? And is Thornton different from other unlicensed or flapper tracks in the UK?
We're the only unlicensed track in the whole of the UK now, apart from Wales, and they're going to become GBGB registered in 2024, I think, January 2024.
Or even this year, perhaps.
Well, maybe even this year. So we are the only unlicensed track in the whole of the UK.
OK.
The one track that was in England, which was at Asken in Yorkshire, has now stopped racing because of the fact that they're looking to become a registered track as well. So they're now building up their infrastructure to make an application.
Is that something you consider, Thornton, becoming a...?
Not in the immediate future.
No. OK. Thank you very much. That concludes our evidence today. Thank you very much for your participation. It's very much appreciated. We now move on to our next item on the agenda, which is consideration of consent notification for UKSI, the plant health and phytosanitary conditions, oak processionary moth and plant pests, Amendment Regulation 2023. Do any members have any comments on the notification? Are members content to agree with the Scottish Government's decision to consent to the provisions set out and the notifications being included in UK rather than Scottish subordinate legislation? Thank you. And that concludes our meeting in public, and we will now move into private session. And I suspend the meeting for a few moments.